Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting of the COVID-19 committee. This morning we will be taking evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs, Michael Russell, MSP, who is joined by Dr. Gregor Smith, Chief Medical Officer for Scotland, although I understand that Dr. Smith is running a little bit late. And I welcome you to the meeting. We are taking evidence on this week's review of the levels restrictions and the following made affirmative instruments. They are the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment Number 3, Regulations SSI 2020/389, and the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment Number 4, Regulations SSI 2020/392. Cabinet Secretary, can I invite you please to make a brief opening statement?
Thank you, Convener. And thank you again for the opportunity to speak to the committee. As the committee will be aware, the First Minister set out the outcome of the fourth review of the allocation of the levels to local authorities under Scotland's COVID-19 strategic framework on Tuesday in her statement to Parliament. Although we're encouraged by the impact that the current restrictions have had on infection levels, as the First Minister said, there does remain a need to ensure that, and as such, we've agreed not to propose any changes to levels this week. We've seen some areas improve, some remain broadly static, and sadly, some showing signs of deterioration. For areas that have improved, we also have to consider other issues in reaching a decision, such as general winter factors. I'm sure people can see the snow behind me this morning, and infection levels in neighbouring areas. We also recognise the need to continually drive down rates in advance of the festive period, and the allowances that have been made in meeting other households. For those local authorities that have seen no change or have shown an increase, we will continue to monitor the situation closely and in depth with the local directors of public health and with the National Incident Management Team. This is particularly true this week for Aberdeen City and Aberdeenshire, both level 2, which have recorded sharp increases and are now subject to closer analysis ahead of any firm conclusion. I'm sure Gregor Smith will be able to say more about that. Currently, 11 local authorities are in level 4. These areas continue to be closely monitored, but current trends suggest that it may be possible for these areas to move down on the 11th of December. However, this is dependent on continued progress and will be confirmed at the next review. The next scheduled review will be on the 8th of December. We continue to, of course, reserve the right to bring forward if any one or more local authorities changes as and when that situation requires. Now, Convener, the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment Number 3 and Number 4 regulations are also in front of you today. These are two sets of previous level regulations which were made on the 12th and the 23rd of November. As I set out in my opening remarks last week, the regulations placed a number of areas of Scotland into Level 4 as a result of continued worrying data and trends. It is our intention for these tighter measures to last until the 11th of December, but of course we continue to review all areas of Scotland on a weekly basis, as I have said. These regulations also move East Lothian down a level from level 3 to level 2. The regulations also put travel restrictions into law. These restrictions prohibit individuals from entering or leaving a local authority area that is in level 3 or 4 unless they have a reasonable excuse. These restrictions are important to ensure we limit transmission from one area to another as much as possible. And finally, Convener, the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment Number 6 Regulations 2020 were provided to the committee in draft form yesterday, and we intend to make and lay them later today. These regulations make provision for the festive bubble arrangements that we set out in the guidance that was published last week and which I discussed with the committee. The regulations also allow holiday accommodation to be used in Level 4 areas, if required, for the purpose of attending a marriage ceremony, civil partnership registration, or to facilitate shared parenting. These regulations will come into force on the 4th of December, but the festive bubble arrangements will only apply from the 23rd to the 27th of December. Now, Convener, I hope the committee has found those comments helpful. I'd be happy to take any questions you have, and I'm sure Gregor Smith will also be in that position. I'm sorry that he appears to have been delayed by traffic.
Thank you. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that statement. If I can begin by asking the first few questions, and my first question is around the number 6 regulations that you finished on. It's my understanding that what the legislation does is just define holiday gathering And applies that as an exemption to the sort of household mixing rules, if I could put it like that, as well as an exemption to the travel restrictions. I think there's real concern that, notwithstanding that, it's a legislative position about communicating these arrangements to the public and how they will work. So could you advise the committee in terms of what the government is doing to ensure that those messages about what people can and cannot do over Christmas are being made to the public?
Well, we are quite clearly using every channel of communication that is available to us to reinforce the messages which we've been talking about for the last week. And I think it is really important that everybody who does talk about these has a responsibility and that includes members of the committee, includes other MSPs, it includes, of course, those who are communicators to the press. It is very important that we are clear in what we say about that, that we are very clear also that these are not compulsions, but they are essentially permissions, and that people should be very, very careful. If there's a single message that we need to get across to people, it is that Christmas is not a license for anything, because the virus is not going away and hasn't gone away. So the regulations and the information is as clear as we can make it. It has been widely disseminated. It will continue to be disseminated. All the channels that we use will be used to disseminate it. And I hope that members of the committee, members of the Scottish Parliament, those who are, as you are also, a health spokesperson, are able to articulate the very clear messages that are in there. And I hope that we'll do that as well as we can. My apologies.
Thank you for that. The issue of the sort of stepping back from Christmas and looking at the strategic framework. These are issues that will be alive to you representing our Garland Buttes. But has the government taken any further steps in exploring whether within each level there are sort of the possibilities of as I suppose, tweaking those levels so that you could, for instance, have a sort of -2 level within level 2? For instance, I think already in level 1, the Highland Council area and Moray are at +1 insofar as there's no household mixing allowed there, which is a kind of additional point within the level. Has the government taken that any further?
Well, as you are aware, Convener, because you and I were both at a meeting with the Isla Resilience Committee 10 days ago, there are proposals from that, certainly from Isla, and I've heard it discussed on other islands that I represent, and they are being very seriously discussed. There was to be a meeting, and I'm sorry that the Chief Medical Officer is still not here, because I would want him to address that. There was a meeting, I think, this week to continue to look at a number of issues that have arisen, and this is one of them. Now, as you are aware, and it's a live discussion, there are two things that really have to be thought about very carefully here. One is, of course, areas which have had limited or virtually no cases of the virus over a long period of time. And that clearly does apply to some of the islands which I represent and which you are familiar with, and to other areas. And if it were possible to help those islands, because there are, of course, other harms which we consider all the time, if it were possible to help those islands, I think all of us would think that would be a good thing. But there's also the indisputable fact that these islands are not totally isolated. Though I've heard it said, and you have heard it said too, that surrounded by sea as they are, they are insulated against what is happening. They are not totally isolated in either direction, either coming or going, either in terms of people coming into the island from elsewhere, and we've seen outbreaks of the virus in places which thought they were cut off from it, for example, recently in Uistan and in Benbecula. But equally, the islands, particularly the Argyll Islands, if you become seriously ill and have to be removed from the island and perhaps airlifted off the island, you go to Glasgow. You go to areas where there's already substantial pressure. And there are issues in there in terms of the overall pressures. So those are the issues that need to be considered, and they are under active consideration. And you'll understand, I'm torn here, because I believe that, you know, from my constituents, I can fully understand why they are arguing this case. But equally, other considerations have to be taken in place too. I think that there are, you know, a range of issues which the professional and clinical advisors are also looking at. And perhaps when the CMO gets here, you would want to return to that and get his view on it.
Thank you for that. My final question is perhaps, again, it's possibly more for the CMO than for you, but there's been quite a lot of coverage recently in the last few days about the position of Edinburgh, particularly in contrast to Aberdeen, and a sense that Edinburgh is meeting the requirements to move to level two, but isn't. Do you have any comment on that?
Well, you know, just as I said in my opening statement, there are areas which are under pressure. There are areas which are, you know, performing very well, and we want to be fair to them too. But I think it is fair to say that this week the view was to try and have as much caution as possible in the decision making, because we are getting close to the period where the Christmas new regulations will kick in, and we do need to make sure that the virus is at the lowest possible level. I think this is an issue that also may well be raised in the contract of Dumfries and Galloway. And it is that caution that is being expressed. There was a very detailed discussion of this, and, you know, at the Cabinet, but there has also been, I'm sure there will be discussions in the incident management team. I'm sure that the clinical advisors have discussed these issues, and I'm sure those who talk about the four harms have discussed these. There is a very cautious approach, which is very much required at this particular moment in time. I think I now see that Gregor Smith has joined us, so he might want to add something about the caution that's being shown in Edinburgh and in Dumfries and Galloway, and perhaps also address the point that you have raised with me, which is in terms of the what might we call the level two minus arrangement that might come into place, and the fact that I know that was to be discussed by others during the week.
Good morning, Dr. Smith. Can you hear us all right? And
I can, Mr. Cameron, and thank you, Mr. Russell. Apologies for being delayed in joining you this morning. When we approached the discussions in relation to how we change these levels, one of the principles that underpins all of that is the public health principle of precaution. What we want to do is to make sure that we have seen sufficient stabilisation, particularly in the transmission of infection in those areas, before we proceed to begin to allow more people to come together. I think we've spoken about that on this committee before, and I think people understand that the more interactions we have with other people, the more likely it is that we see infection and transmission occurring. As a consequence, we've examined the data in some of these regions very closely over the last week, and particularly when it comes to the Dumfries and Galloway, one of the considerations there has been not only just the stability of the data within that region itself, but also the infection rates immediately surrounding that area and what impacts they may also have within that local authority region as well. In discussion with the local public health teams, one of the concerns that they had in particular was the possibility of this point in time when Dumfries and Galloway's levels of infection, although much improved from where they were, the possibility of further introductions of infection from surrounding areas, particularly mindful of the transport routes, major transport routes that pass through that area as well. I think that there is much in particular that is encouraging about the progress that Dumfries and Galloway has made, and it certainly appears to be stabilising. But at this point in time, we don't yet have just that long enough period of stability and low enough prevalence of infection rates within that area to be confident that it's yet time to open up those interactions and drop down the level again. Over.
Thank you for that. Can I next turn to the Deputy Convener, Monica Lennon, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I wanted to ask the Cabinet Secretary, first of all, about the number three regulations in respect to the restrictions on travel. And I suppose I want to begin by asking what evidence is available to the Scottish Government that travel, that travel contributes to an increase in COVID-19, and related to that, what evidence is there to support the restriction of movement at a local authority level rather than allowing travel between local authorities at the same protection level? So in my local area, for example, North and South Lanarkshire.
Thank you. I think I want Gregor Smith to address the issue of evidence, because quite clearly that is a piece of advice that comes from our advisers. But I just would make the point that the local authority, as the level for restriction, is something that has been thought about again and again. Local authorities in Scotland are not entirely cohesive units, and there is quite a lot of variety in local authority units. But I suppose you have to have some measurement. There was a time when we were looking at this in health boards, but health boards are equally, they're not units that leap to mind as being cohesive and having identity between them. This is a perpetual problem in Scotland. I on boundaries and voting systems some 15 years ago, and we addressed the problem then and didn't solve it. You have to have administrative units. Those administrative units have been essential in the decisions we've been making on the pandemic, but they're not necessarily, they're not God-given, and there are issues between them. But we have to do something, and I think this is the right level at this stage. But then, of course, the issue that the convener raised early on of whether there should be changes within those units is something that is being considered and will be a live consideration, particularly in areas that have very, very big disparities between, such as my own area, between remote island communities and, in areas of some population. But I think Gregor would be the right person to address the issue of why these travel restrictions are necessary. And I believe they are necessary, and I believe they are showing their worth, by the way.
Thanks, Mr. Russell. I'm firmly of the belief that travel restrictions are necessary at this point in the pandemic and in terms of a response just now. And there is a very fundamental public health principle that supports the use of those travel restrictions just now, particularly in limiting the ability for us to be able to spread infection from areas of higher prevalence into areas of lower prevalence. We know this from the data and the evidence that we have collated over the course of our pandemic experience as well. If you look back to the months of July into August, when our levels were particularly low at that point in time, what we can actually begin to see and to track through some of the genomic sequencing projects which are underway is the influence of travel in terms of introducing new infection into areas of Scotland. It's particularly a problem when you have gradients of infection within a country. So at times when we have an infection rates which vary across the country, the travel restrictions become particularly important. It's not just at those times, and I want to emphasise this. One of the aims of having travel restrictions in place, one of the benefits indeed of having them in place, is to try to again limit the mixing that we see across the country and concentrations of people coming together in particular areas which might attract greater crowds of people. And by doing that, what we can do is we can reduce the opportunities for those infection bridges to open up between people and for transmission to occur. It's a tried and trusted method in public health responses to any kind of outbreaks or epidemics. It's used not only within Scotland, but across the UK. We've seen it introduced in terms of responses to try to control the infection. And indeed, it's being used globally in that, for that same respect as well.
Thank you. We'll all know from our casework that it's helpful when an employer has a letter, an employee has a letter from their employer to say that they're a key worker, and if they're stopped and asked by the police, they can produce that. Is there a simple definition of what is an essential journey in terms of the public understanding, and has there been thought given to who could issue a letter of comfort? I know we've probably all had a lot of casework in this respect, and we've all tried to help people understand the regulations and the exemptions and how it might apply to them, but we don't always know all the facts, and it's difficult to give someone an exact answer, but sometimes it's very time critical. So could we maybe get some clarity on what is an essential journey and how does someone prove that? And will Police Scotland be expected to carry out arbitrary stops on vehicles in order to ascertain whether the travel restrictions are being breached?
Well, we are all faced with these challenges. You're right to say that, you know, in our own constituency work. And we have people, you know, who want us to say, you can do this. So, you know, you have my permission to do this. And we are completely unable to do that, and should be. Of course, in France, they had a system whereby you had to have a permit to go anywhere. And I don't think, you know, we have ever considered that to be the right approach to do. I think that would be immensely bureaucratic and very difficult to implement. The legislation is constructed on the basis of, you know, examples of what you know, people would do, but it cannot be completely exhaustive. And we have to encourage, and I go back to the point I made to the convener at the very beginning, we as, you know, parliamentarians, as political leaders in Scotland, have to ensure that we're separating, you know, the seeing the wood from the trees. The purpose of these regulations is really, really important. I've said this at almost every committee meeting I've been at. The purpose is to stop the virus, to make people safer. So people have to ask themselves a very basic question. And the basic question is, do I need to do this? You know, and is there another way of doing this so that I am not moving, you know, across the countryside? And I think, you know, we have to help people to understand that. Now, we cannot possibly say to people, you know, yes, you can do that, but no, you can't do that, because our interpretation will be different. Equally, we must show compassion where it is required. You know, some people get a bit fixated on regulations and think that, you know, they're absolutely solid and nothing can change within them. You know, we've all had constituents who've been in terrible personal circumstances. And we've had to say to them, the regulations are not designed to persecute you. They are designed, however, to say to people, look, moving about the place, doing these things is likely, at the very least, damage, not to help, and might actually do harm. So think about it very, very carefully. And we give a list, you know, which isn't exhaustive, but it's quite a long list of what would be the reasons why people would have to do it. You know, and for example, you know, the issue of going essential work. We're saying to people, if you can work from home, please work from home. We're saying that to employers. If you know, please allow people to work from home. But if you actually have to go out to work, and there are many people who have to go out to work, then that is legitimate. But then, and this is to follow on, and Gregor might want to say something about this, but then make sure you observe all the hygiene precautions. Make sure you wear the mask. Make sure you are fully mindful, even when you're doing these things, that there are still risks involved. It would be really nice for every elected representative to be able to say, you know, here's a handbook. As long as you do everything in the handbook, you'll be fine. We can't say that. You know, it is a disease which we know not enough about, and we're human beings. So we can't say that. But please remember the purpose of this, because if we keep that in mind, then it becomes easier to advise people. But we can also, finally, convener, only give advice. You know, in the end, people have to make their own decisions. Gregor might want to follow that on.
I think the first thing I would want to say is I very much want to agree with the position that was just outlined there, and I'm very grateful to the support of Police Scotland in managing and supporting the restrictions which have been proposed here. It's not an easy job for them, but I think that the way that they have gone about it is to be commended, particularly in that way of trying to enable and support and educate people to be able to understand the reasons as to why those restrictions are in place. That's very important. What Mr. Russell has outlined there should never be forgotten. But we should also remember that travel restrictions in themselves are not going to solve all the problems. And this is the bit that I think that I would want to emphasise and develop here. If people are unsure of whether they should be travelling for a particular reason or not, I think that question that they ask themselves is really important. What is the risk that I may potentially pose to others, or that may be posed to me by undertaking this travel? And if people are uncertain, then they should really question the reasons as to why they're beginning or considering that travel. In the first place, travel alone won't stop the spread of this virus. The other measures that we've outlined, particularly in the Facts campaign, I have to say, the face coverings, the avoiding crowded places, the making sure that we're continually keeping up with our hand hygiene, cleaning surfaces around about us, keeping our 2 metres distance from others when that's possible for us to do. So those are the things alongside these other restrictions which are going to make the biggest impact. And I have to say that I think by and large people understand that and are being very careful in terms of their approach and making sure that if they do travel, that they're undertaking that, as I say, for very good purpose. There is a list, of course, in the guidance that suggests reasons as to why people what would be a legitimate reason for travelling. I think it's really important that people also understand that whilst we're trying to limit movement and the spread of infection, there are very, very clear and legitimate reasons as to why people should still travel, including for essential work, for education, for healthcare in particular, to provide care to others. And also there are safeguarding issues in relation to that as well. So as I say, I think that the guidance has been illustrative in terms of trying to inform and educate people the reasons as to why they may still undertake that travel outside their own local authority area.
You know.
Can I just come back on travel quickly? I think last week the First Minister identified that the restrictions were having an effect, and I think I remember the figure of 10% decrease. I don't want to misquote her, but I think that was a roundabout the figure used. Does the government have any updated information about the efficacy of travel restrictions?
Camino, I think the best thing I could do here is to try and seek you the latest information. There is regular information on travel trends, and if the committee is not getting that regular information, I don't see why it shouldn't have that information, then we'll make sure you have it.
Thank you. Our next questions come from Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, everyone. I'd like to ask some questions about the vaccine rollout. I don't think anybody underestimates the scale and logistics, and they're quite daunting. I think we were all, obviously, there was a collective sigh of relief that there is a vaccine now available. But I understand that the vaccine has to be packaged in units of 975 doses, and that special consideration has to be given to how, where and when they are broken down. So how will these storage requirements impact the rollout in remote areas and islands like Shetland? I wonder if a Cabinet Secretary could explain this process, please.
It is a very important issue for my own area too, and clearly an important issue for every rural area. There will be a statement this afternoon from the Health Secretary on, I understand. I think that all of that detail needs to be dealt with by her. Gregor might want to make a number of remarks, but nobody is endeavouring not to say what this is. But I just want to stress that, you know, from the availability of the vaccine yesterday, that there are still questions to be answered. A great deal of work is being done to answer them, and there will be, you know, further information as quickly as it can possibly be provided. And the point that Beatrice Wishart makes is a vitally important one. You know, and one I would want to have the answer to as well.
I'm very happy just to say a little bit about this. Isn't it wonderful news that we now have this approval to supply this vaccine granted to us? And it's something that each of us has waited for what feels like a very long time to be in the position to be able to actually take forward some of the planning that has been in place for many weeks and months now and put that into practice. So we have known for some time that this particular vaccine, the one produced by Pfizer-BioNTech, has some logistical challenges associated with its deployment, and not least of those is the fact that it has to be stored at ultra low temperatures. It has to be stored at temperatures lower than -70, and then has a very limited shelf life, if you like, once it is taken out of that temperature requirement as well. So there has been planning put in place for this for some time. We've been liaising with MHRA in terms of how we can approach the deployment of it in a safe way, and to make sure that we don't compromise the efficacy of the vaccine in any way as we do so. We have ultra low freezers now in place in every board area in Scotland to store this vaccine, and we have mechanisms by which those very large packs that you've described can be packed, what the term used is packed down into smaller requirements so that they can be deployed as they're needed. All those final plans are now being put in place walked through so that by next week we'll be able to begin the actual process of giving the vaccine to the first people across Scotland. And I have to say that I want to express my absolute gratitude for everybody involved along that chain for bringing us to this position, not just the wonderful teams of researchers and scientists involved in the development of the vaccine, but also everyone along the way, including the volunteers to the trials that have proved both their effectiveness and their safety, the regulators, and of course our wonderful teams across Scotland in making sure that we're prepared to start giving this vaccine as soon as it's available to us.
Thank you, that's a helpful answer. If I've understood you correctly, you said that this was the freezers were available in every Boer area. Does that include the island Boer areas as well?
It does. My understanding is that every territorial board has access to these freezers for storing the vaccine, and that each one of these health boards is also liaising and providing information as to how they will deploy that as well.
Right, okay, thank you, that's helpful. My next question is about travel arrangements, which I asked about last week. I have concern about, you know, Christmas travel in case capacity is stretched, and we're already hearing reports of a March spike in bookings. So there's concern that travel providers won't have the headroom to safely accommodate those who need to travel. And yet, I understand that there are plans to take away 20% of trains 10 days before the travel window starts. So I wonder, Cabinet Secretary, if you could give an update on the travel front.
As I indicated last week, our expectation from the beginning is that there would be pressure upon the travel services available. That's why I answered you last week very clearly that there should be early booking. I'm happy to ask the Transport Secretary to provide you with a comprehensive update of exactly what the situation is as quickly as possible. I hope, and very much hope, that those who require to and decide that they must travel, and we are saying to people, this is an option you have, not anything we would want you automatically to take up. I very much hope that they are able to do so. But I think we have anticipated from the very beginning that where there was pressure, then people needed to book early. But I'll ask immediately after this, and indeed those observing this who are officials will know that I'd like this to be done. I'd ask the committee to be briefed on an update on what exactly the situation is with transportation.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Our next questions come from Shona Robertson.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I just want to, first of all, pick up where Dr. Smith left off. Very good news about the vaccine. I think this is a tremendous week and gives people hope and light at the end of the tunnel. I guess one of the risks, however, and I know you'll be more than aware of this, is that people think job done, that's it, we can relax, whereas we all know that it's going to take time and that people still need to abide by the restrictions. How do we get that message across in the light of, you know, the jubilation, quite rightly, about the vaccine? How do we get the message across that, you know, it is going to take time before things get anywhere near back to normal?
Ms. Robertson, I think this is a very important point.
On you go, Gregor.
Yeah, I think this is a very important point. It's one that has been discussed very, very carefully. There needs to be very clear messaging about the purpose of deploying the vaccine at this point in time, and that's for the direct protection of the people who receive that. Hopefully, within time, we will develop greater data in terms of the vaccine effectiveness in preventing transmission between people. That data isn't yet available to us, but will be developed over the course of its early part of the deployment. But the prime focus of this is to make sure that those who are most vulnerable to the effects of COVID-19 are receiving the right level of protection from this vaccine, and making sure that we protect the the risk of particularly death or serious illness as a consequence of COVID-19 by using it. And there is a very clear risk within that as people see more and more people becoming vaccinated, that perhaps they become more relaxed or less careful about carrying on with all the other measures which we know will reduce transmission between people. I think that we are keeping a very, very close eye on the impact of prolonged COVID, what's become known as long COVID, and the effects that that has on people. And there's a very clear need for us to make sure that we are preventing further morbidity as a consequence of younger people contracting COVID-19 as well, because of the our increasing knowledge in relation to long COVID as well. So there has to be a very clear message that whilst this vaccine is absolutely wonderful news in terms of reducing the risk of particularly death in those who are most vulnerable, and that alongside that, we for some time yet, we need to make sure that we are taking those extra precautions to try to limit the spread of this infection, to make sure that we reduce the morbidity, the illness, and put some of the longer term consequences of that in those younger populations as well.
Thank you for that. And presumably there'll be a communications plan around that, plus obviously the encouragement for people to get the vaccine. There is unfortunately a very vocal minority, as you'll be more than aware, on platforms like social media that cast doubt on the safety of the vaccine, for example. So what can we do to get across the message that it's really, really important that when your time comes and you're offered it, that you absolutely take the vaccine?
It is really, can I just, with respect, knock that back to Shona Robertson and to the committee, as I did earlier on with another issue. It is very important that all of us are saying some very clear things. Now, there will be a communication strategy. There will be a very strong push on this. But we need to say, first of all, this isn't over. That it is absolutely vitally important that the regulations we have are observed, and that we do not think that once we've got to Christmas, there's a vaccine, yippee, that's it. We have all got to say that. And the second thing we've all got to say is that the vaccine is one of the most important means, as Gregor has indicated, in which we can stop people dying. And we need to tell people that very, very clearly, and not brook any nonsense about that comes from other people. And thirdly, for those who are concerned, and there are people who are concerned and who are worried and who don't understand this, they need reassurance from us. They need reassurance that this has been done well, positively, has been done with enormous ingenuity, hasn't taken place. I noticed yesterday the nonsensical remarks being made from certain quarters that had only taken place and approved so early because of Brexit, that none of us should indulge in that complete nonsense. We should be saying this is a wonderful thing that people have done and worked incredibly hard at and are still working hard at, because there are other vaccines, of course, in the pipeline, and that we indicate that as a society, together, if we get this right, then we can move on from a terrible, terrible experience. And it's all our responsibility to do so.
Thank you. I couldn't agree more. That's very helpful. Just one final specific question about the social isolation payments. An issue has been raised with us around eligibility, and for those particularly on the legacy benefits, not universal credit, that there might be issues about proving eligibility. Is that something you're aware of, and is there something we can do to help local authorities be more consistent around the application of eligibility? Because obviously making sure people get access to the self-isolation payment is very important, and we don't want to put barriers up in the way of that.
It is vitally important that two things happen. One is that there are no barriers put in place. So I would want to take that issue away and to give you a definitive answer on it from those people who are dealing with it. I know there is a problem in one or two areas that needs to be resolved, so we'll get you that. But the second one is just to stress the flexibility that is required by local authorities. I've been involved in a particular case in my own area this week, where I think for the best of reasons, you know, it has been quite torturous to get through the process. It is really important that, as all local authorities were doing, and my own local authority is no different, very important that there is as much flexibility as possible, particularly with discretionary payments, so that those who genuinely need help are getting help as quickly as possible. And that's a principle we should apply. But on the particular issue you've raised, let's see if we can get some information and get that resolved.
Okay, thank you. That's all from me, convener.
Thank you, Shona. And our next questions come from Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks, convener, and good morning to you both. I wanted to just try and get my head around how the criteria around ICU capacity is being factored into decisions to move areas up a level or potentially down a level. And I was looking at the figures for Stirling. Stirling didn't meet all of the indicators for moving it from level 3 to level 4, but on ICU capacity, it did. And I think the figures were, it's forecast that there might be a requirement for 17 ICU beds. The double of the current capacity would be 14, so it clearly knocked it into that threshold. How are these ICU estimates actually worked out? Because obviously Forth Valley priority areas, and that would indicate to me that there's only seven ICU unit beds available for the whole Stirling Council area, which is a vast area. It's, you know, Bannockburn to Tyndrum. So I'm trying to get my head around sort of how health boards are actually potentially using each other's capacity, or if there are allocations for particular council areas. Because obviously, like, the implication for Stirling has been quite severe in terms of moving from level 3 to level 4 on that what appears to be a single criteria.
Well, that's undoubtedly one for the Chief Medical Officer.
Thanks, Mr. Ruskell. Yeah, can I first of all emphasise that when we take the decisions on any local authority, it's no one indicator that rides over the rest. There's no one indicator that has hierarchy or precedence over the rest. It is it's particularly the blend of indicators and what information that provides to us. The indicators are very helpful for understanding the pattern that is developing within each of these local authority areas, but it's often the trajectory within that pattern which is most important. And again, if I go back to that precautionary principle, which I discussed at the beginning of the hearing today, very much if you see a pattern of increasing cases developing, particularly at speed, it does concentrate the mind as to whether an earlier intervention can prevent further harm in the future. And that's one of the basic tenets of that public health philosophy as well. In relation to the intensive care projected data that you're seeing there, it's modelled using our analyst teams here within Scottish Government. We would be delighted to provide you with further information as to the exact way that they develop that modelling. It's agreed with the health boards in terms of the using data on the kind of trends and infection and what would be if you like predicted to happen from the caseloads that they're seeing within hospital. We're able to predict from our knowledge of the number of people who tend to convert either to hospital admission or to require ICU care, what the levels are likely to be. But there are also confidence intervals within those predictions as well. And as I say, the analyst team can give you more information in relation to how they come about that. In terms of the way that those health boards interact with each other, we are able to expand the capacity within each of those health boards at very short notice. But we're also able to, and health boards are also able to interact with each other as well, so that if one area was particularly coming under pressure and was requiring assistance in identifying additional capacity within, for instance, the ICU bed complement, they can speak to neighbouring health boards for that mutual aid and to be able to kind of gain support from there. So although the ICU and the hospital admissions data are both important aspects of the considerations when we're approaching the decisions to apply any levels within each area, by no means are they the sole characteristic that we would look to. And in fact, one of the key things which was influencing the decision to move in Stirling wasn't solely the impact that this would have on local health services, but actually the local evidence which was there for the origins of the infections, the rising infections that they were experiencing. These local conversations with public health teams who are engaging with the people who are testing positive are really important in coming to a conclusion as to whether there are particular incidents or clusters that are driving the case numbers that we see, or whether there is something which is happening which is much more indicative of community transmission. So are we getting a large number of sporadic cases that you can't link necessarily to other cases, which might imply that there is background community transmission occurring to quite a significant degree. And in Stirling, one of the considerations that we had there was that in particularly some of the areas of Stirling, there was evidence of that community transmission which was uncontrolled.
I mean, I think the issue here is about clarity, isn't it? So, you know, constituents will write to me from Stirling saying, well, you know, we're only meeting one out of five of these threshold criteria. And that wider picture that you're describing around community transmission, the decision making around that isn't really clear when these decisions are announced. So I don't know if there's more kind of granularity in terms of the decision that you can make available. And clearly, you know, the data around ICU unit capacity is part of that picture, but not the only part of it.
The directors of public health have now started returning a narrative to us as well that we can build into some of that decision making process. And you'll be aware, Mr. Ruskell, that we publish the evidence behind some of these decisions on a weekly basis as well. The indicators, as I say, are very, very important in informing that discussion around these decisions. I think it would be it would miscategorise the way that we use those indicators to say that they solely drive the decisions. One of the important, and in fact one of the critical aspects, is to look at the dynamic nature of the data within each one of those indicators as well. And if we're seeing a fast emerging picture there, then, as I say, that one of the fundamental public health principles that sits behind that is not to wait until you have reached any kind of particular level or any sort, but to act in a way that prevents further harm, because you can now predict where this is likely to travel to.
Okay, and can I turn to the self-isolation support grants? So yeah, very much welcome the shift in the conditionality for those support grants this week. Things moving in the right direction. But can I ask Cabinet Secretary about that tricky issue of proving eligibility? I mean, this is primarily now a job for councils to make that judgment. But you know, we're going through a very difficult period now. There'll be people who are in very precarious work, people who may lose a job at short notice, people who are self-employed, who may face a sudden drop of income. Are you clear that for those people who perhaps don't neatly fit with the conditionality and the requirements, that they'll be able to access the self-isolation support grants quickly and enable them to do the right thing and to isolate without fear of going further into poverty? And how will you actually monitor this going forward?
As I've indicated to Shona Robertson, you know, I think flexibility is absolutely vital in these circumstances. I also believe, as a constituency MSP that, you know, receives views and concerns and sometimes very distressing cases all the time, as constituency MSPs do, in those circumstances, I understand the need to make sure that we do everything we can to help people to isolate. And that's also important from a public health point of view. So, as I indicated to Shona Robertson, I will endeavour to provide information to the committee as a matter of urgency, which show what we're trying to do, which encourage local authorities to be flexible. There will always be circumstances in which people find themselves on the very edge of eligibility. We should be erring on the absolute side of not generosity, but inclusion, wherever we can do so. And that's what we will try and do so. I just want to reassure the committee, there is no difference between the government and the Parliament on these issues. We want to make sure people are helped. There's no question of holding things back. We want to make sure people are helped. That is, you know, it would be utter foolishness not to want that. So just we have to get the systems to work. And you know, sometimes over years in government, you learn that getting systems to work is very hard, and you have to put a lot of effort into it. But the effort's going in to try and make this work. So we'll provide that information.
Okay, that's welcome. Can I just finish by asking about, you know, the communications plan? And Shona Robson has already raised the issue about vaccination and the concerns there, because obviously we need to get over 80% of the population vaccinated for it to be in any way successful. But there's another aspect to the comms plan. I mean, you talked earlier on about the importance around disseminating the guidance around the relaxation over Christmas, and that, you know, we've all got a responsibility to do that. But even with that guidance, families will have to make decisions about what the best thing to do is for Christmas. I mean, we're having to make a decision in our own family about whether we meet, you know, relatives for 80 or not. Now, technically, we can do that. But there are also questions then about, well, what do we do to further minimize the risk? Should we self-isolate? You know, what's the wider kind of package of guidance that people...
It's in the guidance.
Yeah. Enable them to make that decision.
And it's in the guidance. I mean, you know, the guidance says that if you have doubts about this, then, you know, a period of, you must make your own judgment. I mean, you know, in the end, human beings have to make judgments about their lives. But we're doing everything we can do to help. And in the guidance, it says, you know, if you believe that there is a risk, you might want to have a period of isolation, you know, before Christmas. It's in there. It's worth reading. It's worth thinking about. And certainly, you know, we do hope that people will. I use the phrase again. I've used it twice already in evidence here. Err on the side of caution. Always err on the side of caution. You know, we're dealing with a deadly virus. We therefore, you know, be as careful as you can be. Apply all the rules of hygiene, all the social distancing. If it is helpful and useful, and you think it is, and the guidance says it is, then do have a period of isolation. We all need to understand that, and then we all need to talk about it, and we will have to apply it in our own lives.
Well, I'm feeling cautious, but how long should I self-isolate for then?
Well, the guidance indicates that there's a period required. Yeah, I would commend the guidance. You know, I mean, Gregor might want to say something about the general issues here, but I would commend the guidance. It is clear. It is there. That is why it is published, and we're listening about it too. I mean, we had a dramatic example of that last week when Beatrice Wishart asked about overnight ferries, and we were able to say, well, gosh, that is something we need to do a bit more about. It is in there. Perhaps Gregor would just want to say something about meeting elderly people and a period of isolation beforehand, because that also is a piece of professional advice that can come from him.
Thanks, Mr. Russell. I mean, we know that there will be people who are thinking very, very carefully about how they approach this period in Christmas, and I think particularly for those who will be coming into contact with across the generations in the home, they do need to give some very careful thought to the risks that may pose, particularly for those more vulnerable people. And we know that age is a major factor in terms of how this virus can impact on people's health. So if you're within a family that has older people and that you are very keen to interact with during that time, I do think that it is wise, sensible, to kind of make sure that the precautions you're taking beforehand limit the possibility of people within that group passing on the infection. How do we do that? Well, first of all, again, it's just going back to the basic principles of making sure that we limit our ability to be able to to become infected with the virus. Part of that is about making sure that the interactions we have with others, particularly for the at least the 7 days beforehand, are limited to essential interactions only, to make sure that when we are interacting with others, that we're keeping a distance, that we're making sure that we're wearing face coverings when that's appropriate to do so, that we're cleaning our hands regularly, and on. I think all of us are familiar with that now, but it's particularly, we know that the majority of people who are likely to become infected and display symptoms with this virus are likely to do so within about a 7 day period with that. That's not to say that it can't happen for longer, but as I say, if people were to limit their interactions with others for that type of period, certainly it would reduce the risk to others. But I think the more fundamental question that lies behind that is, whilst I wholly understand people's keenness to be able to come together at Christmas and to be able to celebrate and to be with people that they've missed dearly, any interaction that we have, no matter how much care that we take, no matter how much we try to prepare, any interaction that we have with others from outside our household does introduce an additional risk and an increased risk of transmission of the virus at that point in time.
Do you think that message is clear out there? I mean, you know, the message is giving me about 7 days isolation. It is not something that I really recall.
It's absolutely in the guidance. It's absolutely in the guidance. And you know, if it's not clear, it's a wee bit clearer now, because we've had the chance to explain about it and you heard it from Gregor directly. So that's very helpful, I would hope.
Does Gregor Smith want to add anything to Mark's question?
No, I think Mr. Russell's covered it. I think it's very clear in the guidance. I know that there are there will be further communications and marketing which will support that guidance as well. But I think that the overriding message here is that if people decide to come together at Christmas time, people should be aware that there is an additional risk that is posed by that, and they should pay particular attention if they plan to come together with older people within their family or their friend group, because it may be that they, when they fully assess those risks, that they decide that actually so close to a vaccine being available to them to offer protection, it might just be a risk too far for them, and they might want to hold off.
Thank you for that. Can I turn next to Stuart McMillan, please?
Thank you, convener. It's certainly my first question. It's regarding the regulations number 3 and also number 6. In regulations number 3, section 15, subsection Y, it speaks about exemptions and compassionate reasons. If someone does have to travel for compassionate reasons, are they allowed to stay overnight in an allocation outside of their tier? And also that particular subsection relates to tier 3. And regulations number 6, section 4, at subsection A, there is no indication about compassionate reasons, but section B, there might the aspect of needing accommodation might actually be important because of subsection A. So in terms of the travel, and sorry, I accept also section that regulation number 6 that refers to tier 4 also. So I'm just trying to get a wee bit of clarification as to whether if someone did need to travel outside of their area for compassionate reasons, would they be able to stay overnight in a location?
Well, the answer is yes, because if you look at, what we've done in the regulations on funerals, you know, it is clear that if you are going to a funeral, for example, it would not be possible to return, then you're able to do so. Can I just stress that, you know, the intention of the regulations is to try and stop people travelling in a way and try and stop the spread of the disease, but it's not to persecute people. And there will be reasons why people have to travel, and there will be compassionate reasons, and they will be and should be treated compassionately. So.
Okay. So certainly So that's helpful, certainly for regulations number three. In terms of regulations number six on the tier four, because the 4A obviously it does discuss funeral, marriage ceremony, and civil partnership registration, but the needs accommodation, which is in B, does that also apply to A? Because I wasn't really too sure about that.
And we specifically have indicated that in the cases of weddings, civil partnerships, you know, we've got an amendment now that says that overnight accommodation is possible. I mean, you know, there's a logic to this. You know, how could you take advantage of what was clearly a desire within the regulations to ensure that in these circumstances such attendance would be forbidden, but say, oh, sorry, it only works if you're, you know, you're within travelling distance. If you're, you know, a bit further than travelling distance, no matter what, you can't go, ha ha. No, I mean, it, you know, logically, that wouldn't make any sense. So, you know, quite clearly, it applies.
Okay, well, that's helpful. Thank you. And the questions regarding the places of worship over the festive period, it was any further consideration given to allowing an increase of numbers in places of worship and over that 5-day period?
There's always thought about all the restrictions, and of course this one is very problematic for some people who find it very difficult. I think what we've indicated, you know, in the bubbles is you know, worshiping together is an addition to what we had before. So we're encouraging people to do so. But in terms of the actual capacity, no, the capacity is an issue that is thought about in terms of potential for spread of virus. So I'm afraid that's not changing in that way.
Okay. Well, thanks very much. Thank you, Gabriel.
Thank you, Stuart. Our next questions come from Maurice Corry.
Thank you, Gavina. This is one for Dr. Smith initially. Can I ask Dr. Smith what specific communications, and I know we've addressed them in essence with Shona Robertson earlier on and others, what specific communications are you implementing to persuade those people who are reluctant to have the COVID vaccinations and also particularly to counteract the so-called anti-vaxxers? I want to know the specific communications, please.
Okay, thanks, Mr. Corey. There will be a broad marketing campaign. I think that for those who have are uneasy or have any doubts about coming forward for the vaccine, I think it's very important that those people discuss those very carefully with clinicians. I think that that is the most important part. People have commented on the level of misinformation which is likely to be circulating in relation to the vaccines, and I do think that it is clinicians who, as the trusted voice within the community in relation to people's health, that are most readily placed to be able to counter some of that misinformation that will circulate. The marketing campaigns are in the process of being developed and launched, and we will consider exactly what content is required as we begin to kind of see people's response and some of the concerns that may or may not be raised by that as well.
Thank you very much indeed. I agree entirely with that. Can I come to Cabinet Secretary, please, Convener? Over the Christmas period, we're seeing obviously the opening up, and we're obviously the purpose of this is to combat loneliness at Christmas. I understand that, but the Christmas period opening up could lead to confusion. What special communication, and back to my case of specific and special communications, are you implementing to prevent confusion by the public?
Well, I would dispute the confusion by the public. I mean, we're trying to be as clear as possible. The regulations are clear, the guidance is clear. But I will provide Mr. Corry with a written answer in terms of specific communication strategy from here on in, so that the comms people are able to tell him exactly what we're doing. But you know, if I don't believe there is anything confusing in the regulations, I don't think there's anything confusing in the guidance. I think the conversation we've had here today have shown that. So I would hope each of us, each and every one of us, is familiar with the guidance and going out and saying to people, this is okay, this is what is going on, but also not encouraging people. And I want to make that point again. You know, and Gregor Smith has been very clear about that too. This has been a marathon. You know, we don't want to to throw away the advantage that we've got now or trying to get. So it is not saying to people everything's fine for Christmas. It is saying, as you say, Mr. Corey, if people are lonely, then there is a possibility of some relief.
Thank you, Kevin. Dr. Smith, would you like to comment on that or add anything to that?
No, I think that covers it nicely.
Right. And the final question is one for Dr. Smith. What actions has been taken to prevent the levels in areas potentially rising after the joyous Christmas period?
It's something that we are very conscious of, and we are going to be keeping a very close eye on just now. There will be further meetings over coming days, in fact, just to examine that period exactly after Christmas with the latest modelling. At all times, we try to make sure that our response is informed by the evidence that we collate, and some of that evidence is real-time data, some of that evidence is the modelling which is based on the data which we develop as well. As the latest data becomes available, we will begin to be able to assess what the likely tracks and paths which develop after that Christmas period may be. I suspect that we will see an uptick in infections at that point in time. I think it is inevitable as a consequence of people coming together at Christmas. The degree to which we need to respond to that will depend very much on the degree to which people come together and follow the guidance which has been issued to them. As we track that guidance, one of the advantages that we have of our approach in Scotland is this levels-based approach. And what that allows us to do is to take that data that we have and to respond in a way which allows us to tailor the response to the particular epidemiology we see within that area, rather than a blanket approach across Scotland to be able to kind of address the needs of a particular area through the levels that can be then applied. At this moment in time, I don't think any of us can second guess or should second guess what will happen after Christmas. But my expectation is that from the early modelling is that we are likely to see some signs of an increase in infection at that point in time. And I think, as I say, there is a certain logic to that, given that there will be more interactions during that period as well.
So you feel sufficiently able to cope with that?
I think that we have the mechanisms in place both to be able to respond to that, but also to make sure that we get the signs or the early warnings of anything that is developing. One of the particularly interesting features of our response during the autumn has been our agility in being able to respond to developing situations in Scotland because of the approach that we have deployed, and the very early signs of infection rates which are tracking in the wrong direction, we've been able to, as I say, respond with the type of speed which has enabled us to regain control of those infections in a way that perhaps would not just have been as easy had we taken a kind of broader approach. And I think that we haven't seen the levels of infection, although they've become quite high in some of our areas and quite stubborn in some of our areas, we haven't seen them rise to the extraordinarily high levels of infection that we've seen in some of the other areas of Europe.
Well, thank you. That's very clear. Thank you very much indeed. And finally, can I just say thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for his very clear clarification on the childcare regulations I asked about recently on relation to grandparents. I thought that was a very clear reply. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, to the convener. Thank you.
Thank you.
Just on that last point, Dr. Smith, about sort of ramping up, if necessary, after Christmas, surely there's an issue of a time lag in terms of the infections that may be transmitted at Christmas, and then that being shown through in the data. How do you deal with that time lag?
Yeah, the first indications that we will see in terms of the infections themselves will be the actual case rate coming through, but we'll also be able to use predictive modelling from some of the increased level of interactions that people have. So we have data which comes into us, which shows the level of contact that people have with others, and from that we can start to calculate the likelihoods of different scenarios emerging from there.
Thank you. Can I turn next, please, to Willie Coffey?
Thanks very much, convener, and apologies, I missed about 20 minutes or so of the exchanges there between members and the Cabinet Secretary, Dr Smith, so my apologies if I touch on an area that's been covered, but constituents are asking me this question fairly often. It's about the Christmas arrangements and the 5-day relaxation that we have there. Did we clarify that the arrangements still restrict the 3 households who can come together, but only in one household during those 5 particular days? And can they go to another household within that group, say on Christmas Day and Boxing Day, or can they go out for dinner on Christmas Day? Given that the level that they live in permits them to go to a restaurant. So just could you please clarify that aspect, please, because it's one of the questions I'm being asked quite commonly.
The local regulations, as they apply, are not suspended. There is permission given for certain things to happen, but the local regulations aren't suspended. And equally, the bubble that exists, the word bubble is a good thing. It describes exactly what the situation is. That has to be kept together. So, the people, if the regulation is that, they can be together, then they have to be together. Now, what we need to do is to be very clear that that bubble is the unit on which everything is judged. So it cannot move about the place and it cannot bounce around the place. It has to keep together. So the desirability is that it meets in one place. The desirability is it does not go out and shop and socialize. It is a bubble that is self-contained. All you're doing with socialization is adding to the pressures that would exist, and you don't want to add to those pressures that exist. So I would just think a bit of common sense needs to be required here. Great that people can get together. Great, as Mr. Corrie says, that we should alleviate loneliness. But don't treat this as a license then to have groups of people that can stravague around the countryside. That is not the intention. The intention is to allow people to meet together who have not been able to meet together indoors for some very considerable period of time, and to alleviate the pressures that exist there. I think Gregor wanted to say a bit more about that issue of making sure that we don't we don't give license to a lot of interaction which could be damaging.
Thanks, Mr. Russell. I mean, the more interactions we have during this period, the more likely it is that we'll introduce infection, not only to within the bubble, but actually between bubbles as well. And I think we've just got to be very cautious in terms of our approach. And those local regulations which apply, which are very level specific, depending which local authority that you're in that point in time, are really important. There are certain dispensations that have been granted to that bubble so that they can be together, for instance, in terms of a place of worship. But really beyond that, there is an expectation that when people are out and about, is that they are complying with the local regulations in place designed to try to limit the likelihood of infection across those areas. The decisions to take this approach at Christmas have been very finely balanced, and when you look at the range of harms which we consider, one of the particular considerations of that time of the year has been the potential for people to be more isolated and to feel that isolation more strongly than they would normally. So these bubbles are very important in trying to reduce the harm, the very real harm that could occur to people, particularly in terms of their mental health and well-being, at a time in the year when I think we've all grown used to interacting with others. But we should make no mistake at all that there are some risks in relation to the harm which may occur as a result of COVID-19 at that point in time as well. So ensuring that everybody maintains their vigilance to try to reduce the risk of infection occurring is incredibly important at that point in time in the year.
Okay. Could I ask a question, please, about the Ayrshire situation? Again, it's probably one for Gregor Smith. As you know, North Ayrshire is at level 3 and South Ayrshire, East Ayrshire are at level 4. The local media in Ayrshire are reporting that the East Ayrshire levels have dropped below the North Ayrshire level. So that gives rise to confusion, certainly in the media and some of the public, about whether it's still appropriate for East Ayrshire to be at 4 and North Ayrshire to be at 3 and so on. But Smith, could you just give a little bit of clarity about what the kind of range of decisions you take in relation to this are? And I'm sure it's not just specifically about the numbers on a particular day. What are the wider considerations that you have to apply to keep North Ayrshire, for example, at 3 and keep East Ayrshire at level 4?
Thanks, Mr. Coffey. There's a variety of considerations that enter into the advice that we provide to ministers to enable them to make their decisions in relation to the levels. One of those important considerations, as you say, is the data that we pour over, we understand and we drill down on to make sure that we have a clear sense as to what is happening. And as I say, it's often the trajectory within these areas which is as important as the actual level of the data itself as well. But beyond that, it's absolutely necessary that we understand from a local perspective what is influencing that data as well. So the data is very helpful, but the discussions that we have with local officials and with the public health teams are particularly important in enabling that much richer understanding of what is truly happening, because sometimes that raw data doesn't fully explain the drivers behind the infection patterns or rates that we're seeing within an area. Sometimes there can be particular disproportionate contributions from discrete incidents within that area. That although contribute to the overall data are perhaps being able to be managed and targeted in a slightly different way. So if I can give you an example of that, if you have a particular outbreak in an institution, a workplace, a care home, whatever it might be, with a significant number of cases within that area, there's a very different approach to how you would manage that and contain that as compared to wider evidence of community transmission, which might need a different level applied to it. So all these considerations are taken into place. How do we get the information from that? The information's a very rich tapestry of information from a variety of different sources. They involve some of the conversations that local public health teams and Test and Protect have with the index cases themselves, and actually the patterns of illness which are detected within any particular area. All that is taken together, and we use very balanced judgments to try to come to a position where we better understand within a particular area what is happening. One of the other things that we tend to do, and it's not commonly reported in terms of the data that's produced for each area, but is we use public health tools as well, such as dissemination ratios, the number of contacts that people have, to get a clearer idea of exactly the patterns of spread within an area as well. And all that is part and parcel of the approach too.
That's very comprehensive, Dr. Smith. Thanks for that. My last question, convener, it's about the vaccine and the rollout of the vaccine and how that might impact on the various tiers in Scotland. So I'm keen to find out, at what point do we think we can move an area from one tier to the other? Is it purely on the numbers that we are getting on a weekly or a monthly basis after the vaccine hopefully is proving to be successful? What will it look like? Will areas basically gravitate down towards zero, we hope? Is that the kind of pattern that we're hoping for? And what will be the driver for that to change for us? Probably for Dr. Smith, I think.
Yeah, I'm quite happy to take this question. There is going to be very close attention being paid over this next period to what impact this vaccine has in terms of our ability to be able to change the overall strategy to containing and controlling the virus. Up until this point, the only real mechanism we've had to try to contain the spread has been these non-pharmaceutical interventions, the NPIs, as they've come to be known in our circles. But really, they are the restrictions that all of us have had to grow used to in our everyday life in terms of the way that we interact with others. Over time, having a vaccine as an additional tool in that armoury is going to allow us to gradually, and I emphasise gradually, evolve our approach to the way that those non-pharmaceutical interventions are applied across the country. We'll be working with some of the advisory structures such as SAGE to develop modelling over time that as we gradually see more and more people become vaccinated, the impact that that has on particularly the more serious illness within the community, as to how we can begin to evolve our approach to applying those non-pharmaceutical interventions. And what I would expect to see is that gradually over the course of the early part of 2021, we'll be in a position where we can start to change our approach and gradually relax some of those restrictions that are in place in order that we can go about and have a greater semblance of normality. Now, I say a greater semblance of normality because I think coronavirus is going to be with us. This coronavirus is going to become another endemic infection that is going to be part of globally just there that we have to deal with. What we don't know at this point in time is to what extent the vaccine is going to be a one-off campaign, or whether, like flu, we're going to have repeated campaigns. We simply don't yet know enough about the duration of immunity from these vaccines and from exposure to the virus yet to be able to predict that. I don't think that life is certainly going to feel like it does just now for us in the longer term. I think that gradually, as the vaccine and as more exposure takes place, people will be able to go about what they recognise as a much more normal life. But I do think that it is still a little time away before we're at the stage of being able to relax some of those approaches to how we apply those non-pharmaceutical interventions just yet.
Just very, very briefly picking up on that, Dr. Smith, are you able to say at all when you might expect to see benefit of the vaccine on the numbers that are testing positive? Is it going to be weeks? Is it going to be months, do you think, before you can see, hey, this is having a positive impact in the number of cases we're seeing?
What I would hope to see in terms of the benefit of the vaccine, and we must remember as to the purpose of this particular vaccine and what we're trying to achieve by using it, and the purpose is to directly protect people from the risk of death, of dying as a result of COVID-19. And so we may still see cases of COVID-19 coming through, okay? But what we should begin to see is that some of the mortality that's associated with those cases beginning to drop over time. In truth, the likelihood is going to be that people may still have a modified form of COVID-19. We don't know fully yet know in relation to that, but what we should see is that those very severe illnesses which people are getting as a result of COVID-19 are not happening to the same extent. That's why it's so important, and that's why the JCVI have placed all their focus just now on making sure that we provide the vaccine to those who are most vulnerable in our society, to make sure that they are offered that protection first and foremost. Over time, we will gain and learn more about whether the vaccine has an effect on transmission as well as protection against dying. And as we learn more about its effect on transmission, it's very possible that what we will learn is that the number of cases begin to reduce as well. But I think it's too early to predict exactly what's going to happen with that yet, Mr. Coffey.
Okay, that's really helpful. Thanks very much. Back to you, convener. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. And finally, Annabel Ewing, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and to Dr. Smith.
A few questions. Turning back to the more immediate next 4 to 5 weeks. Next week we will see the review of the inter alia of the 11 local authorities, which are currently level 4. Is it at all likely, my understanding is that it's not, but it'd be useful to hear from the experts, is it at all likely that any of these 11 could move 2 levels? Or if they do move, would it be more likely, given the need in any event to be able to collect data as you move from one level to another, that they would just move 1 level? And in that regard, and going back to the comms issue, if it is the case that all or most or some of these 11 move 1 down, they will have a new baseline, and then you know, in a matter of weeks, they will have a bit of a relaxation if they wish to take it up for the period 23 to 27 December. So I'm just wondering how that comms will work, because that's two big messages in a very short space of time when people are, you know, busy at this time of year. So perhaps I could go to both gentlemen. Thank you.
Well, I think Gregor would be in a better position to answer the detail of it, but just if I could just on the broad brush of it, on the comms issue, yes, there are big issues in terms of communication, and quite clearly we would want to do that a step at a time. The weekly announcement, the period of scrutiny which we're going through, for example, just now, and then the implementation are becoming well established. I hope people are understanding that there is a rhythm to that, and that the communication of what happens is intensive, you know, as the announcements are made on the Tuesday and then through the rest of the week. And that's what we tend to continue to do. We must treat, you know, we can't move Christmas. Christmas is a sort of fixed point, you know. So what we've got is we have also to treat that as a special case, and for people to understand how special it is, and how cautious and careful they need to be with it. So overall in comms, we recognise those challenges, but we want to make sure that people are well informed. Now, this is part of the process. There's lots more of the process so that people can understand the reasoning for decisions, the effect of decisions, and when those decisions will be reviewed and we will keep moving on. And those are important messages we're trying to put out. In terms of how the movement takes place, it is not for us to speculate on that. And that's really important. You know, that is unhelpful to spend all our time saying what's going to happen next week. You know, we shouldn't be doing that. We should be focusing on what's happening now and what actions we need to take now to make a difference. But in terms of how things move and the criteria, I'm sure Gregor can say more than I can.
Thanks, Mr. Russell. Yeah, it won't surprise you that we're charting very, very closely all of these local authorities who are currently in level 4 just now, and we've been watching the data very, very closely on those just now. We continue to meet on a regular basis to discuss that data. In fact, we'll be taking part in a meeting later on today where we'll have some consideration of that. And the National IMT also meets on a regular basis just now where we consider issues like this as well. No firm decisions have been taken at all at this moment in time. It's we still are watching this data very, very closely, and we will be very careful in ensuring that when those local authorities exit the level 4 restrictions, is that the any risks that there may be a re-emergence of any of their infectious case rates becoming greater again are minimised. What we don't want to do at this point in time is, after everyone's sterling efforts to try to reduce the case rates, the infection rates within each of those areas, is to put that at undue risk just before this Christmas period. So we'll continue to use that data to kind of chart our course. We are very encouraged by the trajectory in a lot of these areas. In truth, after these restrictions have been applied, it's really only this week that we start to see the impacts of those fully coming through just now. And as I say, some of the signs for some of these areas at this moment in time are very encouraging.
Thank you for those responses, and it is good news indeed to hear that there are some encouraging signs from the current level 4 areas. Turning to another issue, dealing again with this 4 or 5 week period, and that is Hogmanay. Now, of course,
we have seen the 23 to 27 December proposed relaxation for those who feel they need to take it up, and therefore there won't be any. Do you feel that it would be important, each of you, to have a particular comms for Hogmanay to explain to folk that there's, you know, the 23 to 27 December is passed, you're back to where you are in terms of your own baseline, just to reiterate that point, because, you know, as we know, communication is hugely important, and when you think you have communicated a message, you've got to keep communicating it, really, in order for that to be successful. Perhaps the Cabinet Secretary could comment on that.
Yes, I mean, I think it is important that we say to people, you know, that the Christmas relaxation is what has been planned. There's, you know, a lot of work gone into it, as Gregor Smith has said, very fine judgment has been applied to it. It is not possible to do that twice, and clearly the risk of doing that twice doubles the potential for difficulty. So this will not be a normal Hogmanay. It will be, as what you call it, a digital Hogmanay. I'm not sure you can bring a piece of coal and black bun digitally, but if you can, you should. And there will be no such relaxation at Hogmanay, and the levels applying then will be the levels that will determine what you can and cannot do. And I think we will need to communicate that, and do need to communicate that. And obviously we're doing that by this conversation, and we'll need to do it more systematically and formally, but there's no doubt about that. And you know, the misuse of Hogmanay, and assuming that you can do what you want, will have consequences and cause damage. And there's just no doubt about that. We should be very clear about it.
I like the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I think it's reassuring that there will be a specific communication about the matter, because I think there is a risk that actually, even inadvertently, people may feel that they can do something different to what our daily lives currently involve. My last question, Convener, because I know that time is marching on, that, and to inform the Cabinet Secretary and Dr. Smith, the committee received in advance of this meeting a submission from Samaritans, and it was flagging up a recent survey that they had conducted, and the findings were very interesting. And in fact, there was a debate earlier this week in which I spoke in valuing the third sector, and the Samaritans had made a detailed submission to that. And really, you know, the message is, of course, that they are there 24/7, because for lots of people, you know, they won't have anyone to go and see on Christmas, you know, at Christmas. They won't have anybody at all. And actually, the talk of this relaxation and the bubbles probably exacerbates their feelings of loneliness in this particular circumstance. So, you know, for the Samaritans as one, they have this free phone number, which I'll repeat for anybody watching, 116123. And I just wonder, you know, what specifically the Scottish Government will do to try to ensure that people are aware of organisations such as the Samaritans, a very specific communication, because I think there'll be a lot of people that may need that help.
Well, I agree, and I think any of us who said that you did not recognise the extraordinary pressure of these circumstances on everybody, and the effect they have on mental health and well-being, would not be telling the truth. You know, and it requires each of us to start with to recognise that, and to be conscious of the difficulties causing to ourselves, because each of us will experience that. The greater difficulty it may be causing to others, you know, to go back to your Hogmanay theme, to take a theme out of, you know, perhaps from Burns himself, and to gently scan our brother man, still gentler sister woman, to be kind to each other, you know, and to recognise the pressure that exists on each one of us at this time, but also to recognise that those pressures are sometimes intolerable and feel intolerable to people who require more help, more support. And therefore, we should be promoting, as you have just done, the places that help is available, just as the government promotes where help is available for businesses and individuals who are suffering financially. We should be promoting, and are promoting, and I know we are promoting, the mental health services and the other services available. I take the point that perhaps even more should be required at this season, and we'll take that away and look at that very carefully. But I have to say that each of us, again, and this has been the theme of this evidence session, each of us, you know, people on the committee, individual MSPs, members of government, even advisors, you know, all have a role to play in this, and have a role to reach out at this time through the various organisations. I started to an early question from the convener was about the meeting that he and I had with the ILA resistance group, resilience group. There are resilience groups and others supporting in every community, and we should support them as well to make sure that they are helping their own communities and we're all doing our bit.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I'm pleased indeed that on the specific issue of Samaritans and the type of help that they offer, that the Cabinet Secretary will take that away and reflect further, and that's the end of my questions. Thank you to both, and thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Annabel. We now move to agenda item 2, and before we do so, can I thank both the Cabinet Secretary and Dr. Smith for their evidence this morning. Agenda item 2 is considerations of the motions on the subordinate legislation that we have just taken evidence on. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to make any further remarks on these SSIs before we take the motions?
No, thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We will be taking each motion individually this morning. So I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S5M23533, that the COVID-19 committee recommends that the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment Number 3 Regulations 2020 SSI 2020/389 be approved. Does any member wish to speak on the motion? And if so, could you please indicate this by typing R in the chat box now? And I see Monica Lennon would like to speak on this. Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Convener. Firstly, I want to make clear that I and Scottish Labour supports measures taken to control the spread of the virus, including limitations and reduction of travel. However, I have listened carefully to the Cabinet Secretary and Dr. Smith today, and I still don't feel fully confident that people have adequate information on what constitutes an essential journey to act in accordance with the law. This lack of clarity risks uneven application and, as a result, unequal treatment across Scotland. And I am disappointed there's not been public consultation and due regard to human rights, given the time that was available to government in advance of bringing forward the regulations. The regulations, as colleagues know, tied together the move to level 4 and the statutory travel ban. Whilst I remain disappointed by the lack of adequate business support for level 4 areas, my objection today to the SSI is specifically on the statutory travel restrictions. I think in general people have worked hard to comply with increasingly complicated regulations, and the vast majority of people are adhering to the travel restrictions. However, given the lack of certainty over what constitutes an essential journey, we should be taking alternative routes to criminality to ensure compliance. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Monica Lennon. I too would like to make a point in relation to this. Having questioned and taken evidence on these various restrictions, it strikes me that the travel restrictions are very significant for a lot of people, both in fact in relation to within Scotland and crossing the border. And the Cabinet Secretary clarified last week that there was no end date on these restrictions. In relation to the restrictions as a whole, we will be voting for them as a party, the Scottish Conservative Party. But we would like to put on record that the travel restrictions are part and parcel of a wider restriction, a weekly restriction regulation. And we would suggest and feel very strongly indeed that consideration should be given to separating out the travel restrictions from the wider restrictions that they are part and parcel of, and not sort of bundled all together. That said, we will be voting for them in committee at this stage, because we feel as a whole on balance that these restrictions, regrettable as they are correct. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to respond to both myself and Monica Lennon?
Well, I would make one, I think, important point, and it's a point that Gregor Smith made during his presentation. I disagree with Monica Lennon that Gregor Smith was not clear. I think he was very clear, the evidence was very compelling. But he made a very important point, which was that there is a global approach to these regulations. In almost every country that you go to, there is a requirement to restrict travel, and travel is seen as being an enormously significant vector in spreading the disease. Travel regulations, while deeply regrettable, and I agree with the convener on that matter, and regulations that we would like to remove at the earliest possible opportunity, are not some curious Scottish affectation. They are a global approach to a global problem. And we should recognise that, because that is the fact.
Thank you for that. I note that no other member has indicated they wish to speak, so I will now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S5M23533 be agreed to. Does any member disagree? And if so, please type N in the chat bar now. One member has indicated that they are not agreed, so there will therefore be a division. Can I advise members that clerks will type in the motion number into the chat bar? Can I then ask all members who agree to type Y into the chat bar first, and then I'll invite those who do not agree to type N into it. Any member wishing to abstain must type A, and the clerks will inform me of the result, which I will then read out. So, can I invite members who agree to type Y into the chat bar now? Has every member who wished to type Y typed it in? Can I now ask any member who does not agree to type N into the chat bar now? Can I ask any member who wishes to abstain to type A into the chat bar now? Just waiting for the clerks to inform me of the full result. The full result on motion S5M23533 is as follows. Voting for: Donald Cameron, Willie Coffey, Maurice Corrie, Annabel Ewing, Stuart Millen, Beatrice Wishart, Shona Robertson, Art Ruskell. Voting against: Monica Lennon. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed to. Can I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S5M23468 that the COVID-19 Committee recommends that the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Levels Scotland Amendment Number 4 Regulations 2020 SSI 2020-392 be approved. Sorry, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary has moved the motion. Does any member wish to speak on the motion? If so, could you please indicate this by typing R into the chat bar? No member has indicated they wish to speak on the motion, so I will now put that question on the motion. The question is that motion S5M23468 be agreed to. Does any member disagree? And if so, please type N in the chat bar now. All members have indicated that they agree to the motion, and therefore the motion is agreed to. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decisions on the statutory instruments considered at this meeting in the coming days. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Cabinet Secretary. Can I thank again him and Dr. Smith for their evidence this morning? I will now suspend this meeting for a changeover of witnesses. Members advise that there is a short time for a break of up to 5 minutes. Thank you. We next turn to agenda item 3, COVID-19 social and economic impact of restrictions over winter. Our evidence session this morning forms part of the committee's work into the Scottish Government's preparedness for key issues that lie ahead in its response to COVID-19. In this agenda item, we're considering the social and economic impact of possible restrictions on travel and social gatherings over the winter period. The committee launched a call for views on this topic, which closed on the 18th of November. And we have also taken evidence from stakeholders in a previous session. This morning, we will be taking evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, John Swinney, MSP. Mr. Swinney is also joined by Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, and Alison Irvin, Director Transport Strategy and Analysis from the Scottish Government. Can I welcome you all to this meeting? Deputy First Minister, would you like to make a brief opening statement before we turn to questions?
Thank you, Convener, for the opportunity to update the committee today on the Scottish Government's plans and approach to managing the disruptions caused to deliberations over the winter period as a result of COVID-19 and the protective measures in place to suppress transmission of the virus. Winter is a challenging enough time of year for our citizens, businesses and public services. Without addressing a global pandemic, the need to prepare our critical public services for winter disruption is this year more important than ever before. As part of preparing for a safe start to 2021, we've had to take difficult decisions to ensure that the way we mark the events of the Christmas season does not set us back in our efforts to tackle the COVID virus. We are working with partners to develop guidance and regulations supported by clear public communications that set out what we think is a fair and safe approach to celebrating Christmas and other winter festivals. The committee will be familiar, as has been discussed, with the decisions around the restrictions that are in place and the protective measures that are in place in local authority areas, and they will of course continue to be reviewed on a weekly basis. We have reached an agreement across the four nations that will allow people to spend time with friends and family for a short period over Christmas. We've done this because we recognise that isolation and loneliness can hit particularly hard over the Christmas period. It's important that citizens make careful consideration of the risks that is associated with coming together for Christmas in order to prevent significant spread of the virus. The most important thing we need to do between now and Christmas is to reduce the number of people in the population who have COVID. Getting the prevalence of COVID down before Christmas will help to reduce the number of people who then might be at risk of passing it on to loved ones. We have set out arrangements in relation to travel, and we ask people to plan ahead in relation to any journeys they may consider, and to ask people to return home by the 27th of December. Transport Scotland is assessing pressures on the transport network, looking at demand and availability of public transport with transport operators. There is a particular focus on ferry and cross-border transport, and at this stage we do not anticipate general availability problems, but this is being kept under active review. We are not announcing any relaxation over the New Year period and have had to take the difficult decision not to relax measures impacting on our lives. In all hospitality settings, those who have formed a Christmas bubble can only socialise with members of their own household, and we're looking at measures to permit Christmas bubbles to come together in self-catering accommodation, and we'll provide guidance shortly on this, this particular issue. We've set out arrangements in relation to Christmas festivities, in relation to the return home for students, and I would want to take this opportunity to record my appreciation to Police Scotland for their assistance in the enforcement of the regulations. We continue to undertake regular engagement with our faith communities and leaders to keep them informed relating to guidance in connection with places of worship and any impact this may have on worship and religious festivals, and how we can better support them in these unprecedented times. We continue to undertake detailed engagement with local authorities on our levels approach, and we will keep this up as we enter the new year. Our approach and principles to protection levels remain based on independent evidence and expert advice, and that will continue throughout the festive period. And I'm very happy to answer questions from the committee this morning.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. We will now turn to questions. If I may begin by asking the first question, can I ask about school holidays and to ask for an update on the government's position about any possible extension to school holidays?
Government, I've written this morning to the Education and Skills Committee to confirm that the government intends to make no change to the school holiday arrangements.
I'm grateful for that. Can I ask next about the many religious organisations that have written to the committee in terms of this period? Obviously, it's a very special period for many religious faiths. And to ask both the Deputy First Minister and the National Clinical Director about what advice they could give to those wishing to attend religious services, given it's such an important part of this period.
Kavita, I recognise this to be an immensely sensitive issue and an issue of immense importance to many, many of us within Scotland. And it is extraordinarily difficult because the importance of participating in religious ceremony and worship at this time of year is of even greater significance to many individuals than it is on any other week or day of the year. However important it is for many of our fellow citizens on every other day and week of the year. So I fully understand the challenge and the sensitivity of this issue for individuals. However, the hard, stark reality is that for religious worship to take place in the fashion that it would ordinarily take place in communities the length and breadth of the country would be to provide an enormous opportunity for the virus to spread exponentially within our communities, I regret to say. So we have in place the restrictions as they are currently stated. We will obviously be looking at those any particular elements of those in the run-up to the reviews that are scheduled to take place. There will be another review of levels announced on Tuesday. And obviously, our decision making will be in accordance with those requirements. I would say that my colleague, the Community Secretary, Aidan Campbell, undertakes regular dialogue with the faith community on faith communities on all of these questions. We understand their concerns. We are acutely sensitive to their concerns. But unfortunately, we find ourselves in a position where we have to take decisions that will be designed to protect public health in these issues. And I'm sure the National Clinical Director will want to add to my remarks.
I thought I was maybe getting a week off, but it appears not. Here we are again. It's an excellent question. I just looked in my diary as Mr. Swinney was speaking, and I am once again meeting the leaders of Scotland's faith groups next Wednesday. I have met them regularly during the pandemic. It is a very constructive conversation, sometimes including the Cabinet Secretary for Communities and sometimes without. And they have, in the main, been hugely supportive. They're, of course, full of questions, and we try and answer those questions. I have enormous sympathy for each of those faith groups, some of whom, remember, have already been through their major religious ceremonies. We have had Eid during this pandemic. We have had Diwali during this pandemic. We have had Easter during this pandemic. And now we are heading to probably the biggest numerically religious and secular holiday in our society in the UK, and it will be different. But nobody can cancel Christmas. So Christmas will happen in a celebratory way in worship groups all over the country, and I would encourage them to do that as safely as they possibly can. We keep that, particularly the gathering guidance, under review all the time, and that still applies. So in level 3, you can have 50 people distanced with face coverings, and that will be the position for some local authorities during this period, and then others will be slightly more relaxed over time. So I am very hopeful that our faith communities will step up. They will be imaginative, they will be innovative about how they do that, just as they have been during this 11-month period where worship services have continued throughout, but have just looked a little bit different. There are some particular nuances around nativity and around singing and carols and all of them, and we're doing our best to give as much detailed guidance as we can. But the fundamentals are, as Mr. Swinney said, if you allow people to meet and you allow people to meet without mitigation, then I'm afraid the virus will spread and January and February will be more difficult than December.
Thank you for those answers. My final question, and we covered this in some in the a part of the session we had earlier this morning, is about how the easing of rules or the creation of the rules around holiday gatherings over the short period of Christmas, how that interconnects with the strategic framework, because I think there's a real concern about communicating this to the public in terms of what they are allowed to do, what they are not allowed to do. And I, seeing as we have the National Clinical Director here and the Deputy First Minister, I'd welcome their reflections on this difficulty of communicating and the public message in terms of Christmas.
I think, Convener, that the public, the first thing that has to be said is that I think the public have generally followed closely the guidance that has been put in place or the regulations that have been put in place. They have carefully been attentive to the detail of those. And of course, in some circumstances, the impact is quite obvious because certain facilities are not accessible and not able to be utilised. For example, Convener, your point in relation to religious worship, churches will be communicating with their parishioners, for example, about the number of parishioners that are able to participate in a service of religious worship and are taking, you know, limiting numbers, taking contact details. So in all of these respects, I think there are practical implications for citizens, which citizens are generally following. I think the communication around Christmas has been really quite significant already. It will be, I think, significant around in the run-up to that period. Some of the messaging we're putting out just now about travel, for example, indicates that if people are proposing to travel, and of course the committee will be familiar with some of the messaging from government in which we are making it expressly clear to individuals that they shouldn't feel obliged to travel for Christmas. It is an option, but they shouldn't feel obliged to do it. That they should plan ahead and make sure that the arrangements that they want to make can be made and can be made safely and sustainably and with the correct protection in place. And those messages will obviously be intensified. Now, of course, I acknowledge that by the time we get to Christmas, some of the local authority levels may have changed. There are reviews to be undertaken and announced to Parliament next week, and that may involve certain change. So there is a communications obligation on the government to make sure that we put that across, and I think generally that is the case. We are focused on making sure those messages are heard, either by our public advertising or by the public communication by the First Minister and her ministers, and by other public authorities, because if I think about a number of the examples where we face challenge around the country, and indeed where we don't face challenge around the country, it is because we've got good joint communication underway between the government and local authorities to advance some of the public messaging that's important in this.
Jason Leach.
Yeah, I think it's a very, very good question, of course, that Christmas does interrupt the flow of what you could describe as the strategic framework. And I didn't hear Gregor's evidence, but I imagine Gregor said it was a very fine balance about what to do, taking into account our culture, our society, and our stage in the pandemic. And the public health advice was very finely balanced. You can see in the communication subsequently by me, by Gregor, by others, that we are worried about Christmas. I make no bones about that. We're worried about people coming together. But we felt that risk was worth taking in order to get reasonable guidance out in a way that would allow people to do it safely. But we've suggested it is for removal of social isolation, not for people to have a normal Christmas. And that's absolutely crucial, that we still are inside a viral pandemic. The virus doesn't know it's Christmas, not to be flippant, but the virus will not take 5 days off. So we still have to be very careful. And I have faced two extremes in the advice I've had to give in the last week or so. People who want intimate, individual-based guidance for their Christmas dinner, and others who think, of course, the government should stay out of Christmas and allow people to do as they please. The reality is that we have to give as much safety guidance as we can during this period. But January depends on Christmas, and Christmas depends on now. So the behaviour now matters. And the prevalence falling, as it is falling, as the levels are successful presently, is absolutely crucial for the next 4 weeks.
Thank you for those answers. Can I turn, please, to Monica Lennon, the Deputy Convener?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Can I ask the Deputy First Minister what work has been undertaken to model the potential impact of the relaxation of rules over the festive period and when this will be made public?
The modelling of any particular change of this type is incredibly difficult to undertake. And what we've tried to do is to be pragmatic about the appetite of members of the public to be able to experience some degree of connectedness with family and friends in a very limited way within the period of the 23rd to the 27th of December. And what I think is important is that we have essentially a period that is a slight relaxation on our strategic framework. And our strategic framework is focused on suppressing the virus in a systematic fashion. And as the National Clinical Director has just said, that strategic framework is working because we are seeing a sustained fall in the prevalence of coronavirus within our communities. And what the period around Christmas essentially recognises is that we have to address the fact that there will be an aspiration and an appetite within families to be together. We've tried to make provision for that in a limited fashion. We've not required it or prescribed it of individuals, but have tried to make that available without undermining the strategic framework. But the application of pressure in the strategic framework today is designed to create some of the suppression of the virus that enables us to undertake that relaxation, more confident that it will not have as significant an effect on the prevalence of the virus if virus levels had been at a higher level before that period on the 23rd of December. So it's very difficult to model because we don't know the degree to which members of the public will decide to use this flexibility, but the crucial thinking behind it has been to suppress the virus as significantly as we can for Christmas to avoid any significant impact on virus levels as a consequence of the degree of interaction that takes place in that period.
Thank you.
Sorry, Ms Lennon. I answered this question in some depth at last week's committee. Modelling something as complex as this is enormously challenging. We have two levels of modelling across the UK. We have SPI-M, which is the UK-wide modelling group with the best modellers in the country, and they are trying to model Christmas. But remember, you need two things for modelling. You need data and assumptions. And data and assumptions are very, very hard to come by when you don't know how a population is going to behave. And therefore, they are doing their best, as Mr. Swinney says, to do that. And the other level of modelling is Scottish modelling, which we publish every Thursday. And that will include, to the best of its ability, an attempt to look forward at what we know now and what we will know in the future. But to model something as complex as removing travel restrictions for 5 days and not knowing how populations will behave across all four UK countries is enormously difficult. What we do know is that family household mixing potentially increases the prevalence of the virus. We don't need modelling for that. We just need to know about the virus. And that's why we're cautious.
Thank you, Professor Leach. I suppose to follow on then, can I ask what will happen beyond the 27th of December? When and will the levels in each area be reviewed? Parliament will be in recess, so how will that be communicated if there is a need to tighten restrictions? And then as a final question, don't want to think about worst case scenario, but how is the potential for a surge in cases in January being planned for within the NHS? I'm really keen to hear from Professor Leach on that.
If I could answer, first of all, I think what I would want to reassure Monica Lennon and the committee about this morning is that the government, in its decision making a few weeks ago, looked very carefully at what I would call the medium term of COVID. So we did not just take decisions about the next week or so. We were taking decisions about the remaining period of this year, Christmas, and into the first 2 months of 2021. Because, as Monica Lennon quite rightly indicates, the period of greatest pressure in the National Health Service is the period of acute winter pressures in January and February. So our planning has been to essentially, if I put it into shorthand, suppress the virus as aggressively as we can before Christmas to enable us to be in a position to cope should there be a rise in the prevalence of the virus after Christmas and into the new year, combined with the normal winter pressures that we would experience. So there's been quite a deliberate strategy of suppression for Christmas to enable us to do that. Now, if I look at the numbers that I have in front of me, on Sunday the 15th of November, the number of cases per 100,000 in Scotland was 142. On Sunday the 29th of November, it was 103, 28% fall in 2 weeks. Now, these numbers, I will be beginning to pick up some of the effect of the level four restrictions that were in place, but not an awful lot of it. So I would be optimistic that these numbers will continue to fall in the period that lies ahead, which will get us into a position where we will be embarking on the Christmas period with virus levels much lower than they were in the middle of November. And that was a quite deliberate strategy by the government to create, essentially to suppress the virus, try to depress any future demand that would come on the health service in the start of 2021. And in that modelling, we looked at the normal, just on health service planning, for example, we looked at the normal, if I might call it, run-of-the-mill winter pressures on the health service and demand for beds in the health service in that period, and essentially recognise we would have to provide for that and then put COVID on top of that. So our planning, we believe, is adequate and appropriate to cope with that period. Now, of course, there are some uncertainties about that. The degree of hand washing that's going on in society today is a great deal higher than it normally would be. So hopefully that suppresses some of the routine fueling of winter pressures, because the population, the, you know, hand washing is more regular now, so, and I think that will be sustained. If we have, with no way being disrespectful about this, if we have, if older people are not out and about as much, then the propensity for falls on slippy surfaces reduces as well. So that may reduce demand on the health service in January and February, when that can be a factor. So, you know, there are mitigating circumstances on our assumptions about normal winter pressures in January and February, which we haven't taken into account, but which may well be a factor in suppressing demand on the health service in January and February, which then potentially creates more capacity to deal with any COVID implications. So I would want to assure the committee that the government has looked well ahead to the end of February in making the judgments that we made a few weeks ago, and which, at a time when we knew we were going to be making decisions about relax the strategic framework around about Christmas, to create that balanced approach to what we think demand will materialise. Now, these are, of course, best estimates. I can't, in all honesty, predict what the weather's going to be like. I can't predict how slippy it's going to be. You know, we are, as a government, and I lead this on the government's behalf, looking at concurrent risks. We are currently looking at our resilience planning for the next 3 months. It's based on the assessment of three concurrent risks: weather, Brexit, and COVID. And our planning, and there are, of course, if the committee can conceive of three circles of COVID, Brexit, and weather, and put them together, you can have areas of overlap in the middle where, you know, issues can come together about, you know, Brexit interruption and bad weather and the necessity to get clinical supplies together, and you've got some perfect storms in there. And that's what the government is actively looking at. And I chair a regular call with senior ministers and their resilience partners. Indeed, I'll have a call with the Scottish Resilience Partnership this afternoon to consider these very, very sharp areas of concentric activity. I'm sorry that was a very long answer, convener, but I felt the committee would perhaps benefit from that detail.
I would only add, from a very blunt National Health Service perspective, that we've been planning for winter since June, as we do every year, and we've had to take into account this new infectious agent that we have. We have between 2,000 and 3,000 beds available for COVID, depending on time of year and disease prevalence. We are also ready for flu. We are very hopeful that the flu season may follow the Southern Hemisphere flu season and not be as severe, but we cannot rely on that. We've seen very high numbers of flu vaccination, particularly in our at-risk groups, so that should also help us. We're hopeful that will help us. But we are ready, unfortunately, for more admissions and more intensive care admissions, if we have to have them. We would much rather avoid them. Remember, they come 3 to 6 weeks later than the viral infection. So if there is an increase at Christmas time, it will be some weeks before that feeds through to actual pressures inside our NHS. But we are ready for that, but we want the population to help us not have that spike peak in January, February.
Thank you. Back to you, convener.
Thank you. Next, we have Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. I would like to, my first question is following the theme that has actually been throughout this meeting, in terms of messaging and communication around the festive bubble. And I wonder if I may, I know many MSPs are getting their inbox is full of lots of questions, but if I may just read out this, which is quite typical. It says, I have a question about the visiting guidelines. If you're able to, during the Christmas period, can we continue the permitted level one indoor visits as well as forming a bubble, or if forming a bubble overtakes this rules and means you can only socialise indoors with those in your bubble for the period it's in operation. I read that out because it's typical of the questions that are coming in, and the issue I see is around the actual communication of the message, and I wonder if you could comment on whether you think that the communication needs to be altered in any way so that people, when they do go through the guidance, they are able to pick out exactly what they need.
The first point I would make, Convener, is that I think the fact that a member of the public is raising that question with Beatrice Wishart is indicative of the fact that members of the public want to do the right thing. And I think it's helpful that members of the public air all these specific questions, because I think that's what lies at the heart of it, a desire to do the right thing. My second point is that generally the government's message, and we reiterate this frequently, is to say to people that the best way to deal with coronavirus is to minimise social interaction. Now, I completely understand the perspective that Beatrice Wishart's constituents have about the aspiration which the government responded to positively to undertake in-house visiting because of the issues of isolation and weather and the spread of population in the island communities. And I understand how important that is. But generally, the government would be saying to members of the public, keep your social interaction to a minimum as the best measure you can take to avoid the spread of the virus. So those are two general messages which I think are important. And then on the specific of the point that Beatrice Wishart raises with me, my response would be to say that whilst saying to people, minimise your social interaction, it is still possible for people to undertake household visiting where it is permitted to a limited extent in the island communities and the formation of Christmas bubbles, but generally to encourage people to minimise their social interaction.
So two quick points, Convener. So the fundamental answer to your question, Ms. Wishart, and to your constituent is we'd like them to choose between those two things. We'd like, if you form a Christmas bubble, that is your social interaction. And therefore we would ask them, you've already taken the risk. You have hardwired that risk into your 5 days. And therefore we would ask them to be very, very cautious about meeting other individuals out with their Christmas bubble. If they choose not to form a Christmas bubble, then they are taking the risk in a different way. So they could keep the in-home socialising, depending on which level they're in, if they're in an island community, for example, and not form a Christmas bubble. It's all about reduced risk. I think the communication point is absolutely right. It's a very complex landscape. We have lots of workplace guidance, lots of individual guidance. We try to make ourselves available. Some people are irritated with quite how accessible I am, in fact, to go on phone-ins, to go on local radio stations, to be on the island radio stations to answer questions from the public as much as we possibly can to get that message across. And we also rely on you and your colleagues to, of course, help us with that. And if that guidance isn't clear in any way, then I and others are very accessible to you, so you should feel free to ask.
Thank you. My next question is around education. In evidence to the committee, the EIS shared concerns about the Christmas break being followed by an even higher infection rate and concern about the current numbers of pupils and teachers self-isolating. And Cabinet Secretary, when I asked you on Tuesday about this matter, you indicated that 75% of secondary S4 to S6 pupils have experienced no interruption to their learning. But that means 25% have, and some have had to self-isolate more than once. So given the impact this has on equity in education, can I ask how this is being monitored and recorded?
It's being monitored and recorded through, there's two aspects to that. One is the routine seamless monitoring of attendance by pupils at school, which provides me with daily information that generally indicates that pupil attendance at schools is around about 90% attendance compared to an annual picture in the last year, which numbers are available, of 93%. So it's really pretty high comparative levels of attendance. But there is another level of monitoring which I'm particularly interested in, which I've established, which is in direct dialogue with directors of education, where I have asked for more detail on the degree to, on exactly the point that Beatrice Wishart puts to me, of the degree to which the education of senior phase pupils is being disrupted by periods of self-isolation. There's very limited disruption in relation to actual COVID infection among senior phase pupils, but it's slightly more widespread in relation to pupils who are self-isolating, because that is a material factor in the judgment I have to make around the questions of equity in relation to access to education and therefore in access to fair assessment under the certification process. So I'm looking at that information. It's been gathered by Education Scotland through the Directors of Education, and I'm looking at that regularly, and it's obviously having an effect on the formulation of my view in relation to the equity that's involved in the preparation for the exam diet in 2021.
Thank you. Finally, could I just ask if there's an update on plans around the safe return of students in January to ensure there's not a repeat of what was seen in September?
What I would say is that we are in very advanced dialogue with the university community on this question. What I can say is there will be a staggered return of students after the Christmas and New Year break. They will not be returning in the congested period right after Christmas and New Year. There will be testing. We've obviously embarked on the testing approaches already in all institutions, and that is taking its course and has been well participated in by students. And that testing is underway already. I pay one tribute to the institutions for their cooperation in putting these arrangements in place, and they will be in place for the return of students in the new year, and that will be on a staggered return basis. But we are still discussing the precise nature of that staggered return with universities, and we'll set out details as soon as we possibly can do.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thanks for that. Our next question has come from Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to our panel. Picking up on a point that the Cabinet Secretary referenced a wee while back about the 3-month resilience sort of planning and issues that were looked at, he mentioned inter alia Brexit, and perhaps the Cabinet Secretary could give us some idea of what kind of issues he with regard to Brexit as far as this resilience planning is concerned. Thank you.
The principal issues, Kavita, relate, I think it's probably best to sum them up as probably relating to food supplies and medical supplies. It would be the two issues of, in the current context, probably greatest concern that we would need to be assured about. And as Annabel Ewing will be familiar, a vast amount of the relationship that we have with Europe for the transfer of goods comes through the short straits, we obviously are anxious that if the proper and free-flowing arrangements that we rely upon today are not in place after the end of the transition period, then that raises the potential of delays to the supply of goods and particularly of medical supplies. And that's something that we obviously look to very closely, and we are in active discussion with the UK government about all of these questions, because we need to be assured that that supply route can operate effectively and functionally, and any delays are, well, ideally are eradicated or at worst are kept to a minimum.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I mean, I'm just recalling evidence before the Culture and Tourism and Europe Committee the other week, where we had the Chief Exec of the Road Haulage Association, I think it was some 3 weeks ago now, and he was very forthright at that time. He said that the whole process, Brexit process, in terms of planning was a complete and utter shambles. And I just wonder, some 3 weeks or so later, do we have any clarity? Because obviously, you know, people will be very concerned, in particular with regard to the potential impact on supplies of medicines as to the position, because they want to be assured that come the new year, the medicines they need, they will get.
I understand these concerns, and I think they're legitimate concerns. And if I think back to the no deal planning that was undertaken by the government for the various no deal Brexit scenarios that were faced, and I'm just trying to get clear in my mind when we were facing these issues. I think it was probably in 2018, I think. It's all kind of merged into one, really. And we, one of the principal concerns we had was around medical supplies. And there was a vast amount of stockpiling went on at that time of medical supplies. Now, there is some of that work has been able to be undertaken, but it is dependent fundamentally on what will be the arrangements after the end of the transition period. Now, at this stage today, I cannot confirm to Annabel Ewing what those arrangements will be. I wish we were. It would remove some of that uncertainty and that anxiety for us, if it was the case. But what I would assure members of the public about is that the Scottish Government and our health service are acutely focused on making sure that we maintain the availability of medical supplies in all circumstances, and that these goods have the highest priority for transportation through the short straits. So in that respect, they have got priority, but we have to make sure that that priority can actually deliver the supplies that we require. But there is every effort been put in to make sure that's the case, but in the absence of knowing what the arrangements will be, there is a degree of uncertainty that exists there.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and hopefully this clarity arrives sooner rather than later from the UK Government. Turning to another issue, if I may, the impact on downstream businesses. So, you know, out with hospitality, for example, I was recently contacted by a hairdressing business in my constituency, so Fives Level 3, you know, generations of family in the business, which is often the case actually with hairdressers. And, you know, their footfall has considerably decreased because of travel restrictions. And I just wonder what thinking there may be in the government, in the Scottish Government, to have a look to see what help can be provided, because it doesn't appear that the restriction grant announced the other week would apply in those circumstances, although we're still trying to seek clarification on that.
We've obviously taken a range of decisions about the availability of financial support for business, and I recognise this to be a significant issue for business. One of the, in the design of these schemes, we try to make sure they've got as much reach as they possibly can have, but ultimately, inevitably, forgive me, there will be limitations, which is why we then added on the element of discretionary relief that was available to local authorities to make decisions for different organisations at local level who might be ineligible for some of the support that the government is putting in place through some of the schemes. So I would hope that it might be possible to reach for those funds to reach businesses of the type that Annabel Ewing raises, so that businesses can be helped through some of these very difficult periods. And fundamentally, and this is the challenge with COVID, fundamentally these businesses are sound. They are sound businesses in ordinary normal circumstances. We are not in ordinary normal circumstances, unfortunately. The challenge is about trying to make sure that we configure financial support to enable businesses to reach ordinary normal conditions again, where they can then be effectively performing businesses as we know them to be. And that's the thinking that's gone into the business support that the government has put in place.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I will look into the area that he mentioned further, just to double check the position. One last brief question, if I may, and perhaps I could address it first to Professor Leach. And it's good to see him again every Thursday. It's, you know, where would our week be without him? And then perhaps the Cabinet Secretary, if he wants to pick up. And the question is summer holidays next year. Should people be planning anything, Professor Leach?
That's the my crystal ball question required. I certainly wouldn't book anything you can't cancel and can't get your money back from, but I am very hopeful that next summer will look a lot more normal than the summer we've just come through. So the key intervention here is vaccination. And you've seen the news in the last 24 hours, which is the very, very small green shoots. It's not population level vaccination, and it will not be for some months. But by the summer, we will know a lot more. We will hopefully, with a fair wind, have vaccinated the vast majority of the at-risk community, and we will be into the less risky communities by then. We will know whether the vaccine gives you coverage from transmission as well as disease. The crucial unknown is what will happen in the rest of the world. Remember, this is a global problem. It is not a Scottish problem. And you have to vaccinate Indonesia and Nigeria as well as Scotland. So there will be international travel restrictions, I think, for some time to come. And the WHO are holding the ball on 37 phase 3 trials, on the advice about international travel to each continent, all of that. And that will all play out in the next 6 months. But there is a very, very encouraging start now with the vaccine. My only other point I would make is it's very important to put on the record that the virus might change. If the virus stays stable, this is all good news. But the virologists warn us all the time that there is a small chance that the virus will change. That's not looking likely just now, but we just have to have a note of caution in all of the enthusiasm for the vaccine. So I think we will be going on holiday next summer, but I'm not sure it'll look quite like a normal summer, but it'll look a lot better than the summer we've just had.
I thank Professor Leach for the answer, and perhaps the Cabinet Secretary could just maybe flag up the importance, therefore, of perhaps looking to holiday at home to do something for the Scottish tourism industry.
Well, I certainly do hope that I will have the opportunity to make my ferry booking with Caledonian McBrain next summer. But always do, but it's a wee bit early for that to be a certainty.
Thank you, gentlemen, and thank you, convener.
As ever, the ferry journey to Tyree being amongst the favourites of many people, Deputy First Minister. Can I next turn to Mark Ruskell, please?
Thanks. So it seems that we've now got some clarity as to government's intentions in relation to school closures. You made the decision on that. I have to say that I'm disappointed that I seem to have learned more about the government's thinking on this matter on Twitter and in the media than I have in any answers I've had to questions in this committee over the last month. But, you know, we are where we are with it, yeah? So can I ask another question in relation to this? And it's about the evidence behind that decision. I listened to what you said, Deputy First Minister, about the evidence in terms of education and the impact on education. But I'd also like to know what the evidence is that you've considered in relation to transmission, particularly for the young adults that are in high school, where there's potentially more prevalence of transmission, and particularly in relation to the kind of need to limit social interaction 14 days ahead of the Christmas relaxation coming into force. What consideration was given to that? And if keeping schools open, you know, does keeping schools open, lead to an increased risk of higher infection rates?
No, I don't think it does, and I think the evidence is very clear on that question. There is a growing evidence base about the low transmission levels amongst young people and the low transmission levels within schools. And the overwhelming majority of the cases that present themselves in schools are invariably a product of community transmission and interaction that's taken place within the community. Now, this is a classic area where we have to draw together and reconcile the various harms that can be created around around COVID, because as we know, as the committee will be very familiar, and I've rehearsed this with the committee on previous occasions, that there are a range of harms that arise out of COVID. There's the direct health harm, there's the indirect health harm, and there are social and economic factors. And in weighing up the difficult judgments, and I'm not trying to pretend they're anything other than that, about the Christmas break, I've been very mindful of the advice I've had from the Education Advisory Group, which has looked at the potential for harm for young people, the relative harm for transmission of the virus if young people are in school in an organised environment with proper mitigation measures in place, versus being out of school with much greater opportunity for social interaction and therefore for greater transmissibility of the virus. So, not to mention the issues of consideration of vulnerability that exist for large numbers of young people who rely on school for support and assistance in many respects. So these are finely balanced judgments, and I think in coming to a conclusion on these questions, these have been the factors that I have reconciled in my own mind. I would also put this question very much in the context of the answer I gave to Monica Lennon a few moments ago, which has been about the focus the government has had on sustained efforts to reduce the prevalence of the virus through the various interventions that we've made in terms of the level of restrictions. And we've seen the fruits of that in the reduction in the prevalence of the virus as we speak just now.
Okay, so that position is here now. But if the priority then is education and keeping the schools open and keeping young people learning in that school environment, what is the case then for saying, well, actually, we should be vaccinating teachers sooner than later? We've got, 51,000 teachers in Scotland. How is that being factored into your thinking? Because if education is and schools remaining open, such a strong priority, how will we prioritise that in the way that we go forward with a vaccination programme?
Well, I think there's a really careful discussion to be had here about the wider handling of the pandemic on a whole population basis, and the circumstances of individual sectors, because the government will take advice, and is taking advice, and indeed I suspect the Health Secretary in her statement to Parliament today will set out further details on all of this. We'll take advice from, and the institution has just escaped me, but Jason Leach will come to my assistance, the Vaccination Institute.
The Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation.
Thank you. I'm grateful to Professor Leach, but we will take our guidance from that committee to provide us with the whole population guidance on vaccination policy. That has to be combined with our approach to suppressing community transmission of the virus, with which the committee is familiar and with which we are seeing important progress being achieved at the present moment, because sustained efforts to reduce community transmission is what keeps our schools safe. So I'm trying not to separate out these two issues of whole population vaccination policy from community transmission suppression, but I think there are subtle distinctions between the two, which will, when combined, enable us to make progress on securing the health and well-being of the population as a whole.
Okay, I don't know if Professor Leach wanted to come in on that.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Ruskell. I think there's an important distinction here for the to describe the vaccination programme. Vaccination in the early stages is about individual protection, not about population protection. It will eventually be about population protection. So the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation's advice, which was published in the last couple of days, is very, very clear that you should vaccinate those at risk of disease and death first. That is your number one priority. And the principal way of doing that is to work your way down through the age groups. There are some nuances in there about health and social care workers and those who are treating COVID patients and those at particular risk of COVID. But fundamentally, you start with the oldest and you work your way down. And once you get to the over 50s, they suggest in their advice, you will have at least attempted to remove 99% of the mortality risk from this disease. So therefore, it's a risk-based judgment. If you get 10 vials of vaccine or 10 million vials of vaccine, you work your way through logistically through those age groups. And the only profession they recommend specifically to be removed from that is health and care workers who have direct access to a large number of COVID-positive patients, of course. So that's the advice we will be following, and that's the advice the whole of the UK will be following.
Okay, the BMA yesterday put out a statement and they raised, like many commentators, you know, significant concerns about how the five-day relaxation could impact upon COVID infection rates. I mean, clearly, you know, things could go wrong and you might need to move very fast to make decisions. How effective is the test, trace, isolate system now as a way to understand very quickly what is happening within the population and to take action on the back of that? You know, what about the length of time between the case created to the interview under the test trace situation, at the test trace process that we have? Is that operating more effectively now? Is it effective enough to give you the data that you need to then make the decisions that you may have to take if infection rates go up?
I think I'll say a little bit about this and then Professor Leach will provide some more detail, but I think the answer to the question, I think, is yes. We have a significantly greater testing capacity in Scotland in a variety of different formats, and indeed, you know, we've all now seen the queues that have been at some of the testing facilities in Johnston, for example, where there are a new community testing opportunities available. So we've got much greater testing capacity. I think the data on contact tracing represents really a very efficient and comprehensive approach that's been taken to get around these cases and to put the necessary elements of self-isolation in place to avoid further spread. But I think at an individual level, that is now working much more comprehensively. But I do think it is important that we, and this, some of this relates to what we discussed with Monica Lennon earlier on, I think it is important that some of the messaging that goes on in this question is about trying to minimise social interaction within the population, which remains an important priority to avoid spread of the virus. Because in that respect, we will be able to avoid the circumstances that Mr. Ruskell puts to us that may arise out of greater social interaction. Although the opportunity is there for people to have some more social contact, albeit with significant constraints around about it, people are not obliged to do that. And I think that And as I talk to people and look at my inbox and the feedback from members of the public, I think a lot of people are recognising the opportunity is there for some social interaction, but they've decided not to take up that opportunity. And I think contact tracing enables us to get across that, across any cases that emerge out of that. The other point I would say is that obviously the government is looking very, very closely on a several times a day basis at the data that emerges on all of these issues, so that we can take early and swift decisions, if necessary, to try to address circumstances as they arise around the country. And that will be heavily informed by the work of the contact tracing teams and the national and local incident management.
Okay, a couple of things in addition, Mr. Ruskell. So there was a joint statement yesterday from the what we call the Academy of Royal Colleges, which is the joint set of medical and surgical royal colleges for Scotland and BMA Scotland. I agree with their statement. In fact, I expressed that support on social media. It advises caution over the Christmas period to the population, and I think that's the absolute right message to advise. If you are socially isolated and lonely and haven't seen your family for months, then I'm not telling you not to visit, but I'm telling you to be very careful when you visit, and that's exactly the same message as the Academy and the BMA. To your point about test and protect, yes, by global standards, test and protect in Scotland is working well. It is finding the index cases quickly, contacting enormous numbers of them, over 90%, and getting the contact tracing done. Clearly, as prevalence falls, that becomes an easier job because you have fewer to do. It's just simple arithmetic. Test and protect is very, very helpful at outbreak management. It's very good at an individual level about how you protect you and your family and isolating people out. It's very good at outbreak management, for instance, in a workplace or a factory or a school or whatever that viral outbreak might be. It is not good, because it's not designed to do so, it's not good at understanding broad community transmission and where that transmission may be happening, because this virus doesn't let us do that. I really wish it did. So I still can't tell. I did the Federation of Small Businesses this morning just before committee, and their key question is, where is the transmission happening? And that's the really difficult question. If there are outbreaks, then we can kind of know where it's happening. So if it's a chicken factory or a call centre, we would know. But if it's broad community transmission, we can't know. We just know it's where people are meeting. That's why the restrictions are fairly blunt, and that's why the key thing is, as prevalence comes down, then remove those fairly blunt restrictions.
Thank you. Mark, if it's all right, I think we'd better move on given the time limits. Sorry about that. We've got a couple more members to ask questions. Could I turn to Shona Robertson, please?
Thank you. Good morning. Just picking up on something Jason Leach was talking about, the whole population guidance from JCVI. Does it say anything about ethnicity? Because obviously we know that there's evidence to suggest that people from certain ethnic groups are perhaps more susceptible to the virus, and there's been some research into that. So it's just to ask whether there's anything around the guidance that would prioritise people from certain ethnic groups.
It does. It's not silent on ethnicity, but it adds ethnicity into the risk mix, along with profession and gender and everything else, and it comes to the same conclusion, that the principal risk factor is age. The second most important risk factor is disease, pre-existing or otherwise, whichever ethnic group you come from. And therefore, if you get age groups, whatever ethnicity that is, you will get the highest risk. It also goes on, and all of our individual country guidance will do this too, that you have to be culturally specific in your guidance and communication. So if you are talking to the travelling community, or you're talking to the care home community, or you're talking to the Bangladeshi community, you should use communication strategies that will reach those individuals in a way that is accessible to them. And that's very, very important, because we need all of those groups to come forward for vaccination. So we need community leaders, we need voices, we need others to help us with that communication. But fundamentally, the answer to your question is JCVI say, and I agree with them, that age is the most important distinguishing feature here for this disease.
Okay, that's helpful. My second question is, in the lead up to the Christmas period, there has been advice for a while now about reducing social interaction in preparation for that period where possible. Is there any practical guidance being issued around that, about how people should do that, when they should do it from, or are people just expected to kind of use common sense and just not go out as much, or you know, what's the advice?
Kavira, the advice is essentially communicated through the government's persistent messaging on these questions, which is either through the briefings that the government undertakes, or whether it's through the paid advertising or through the broadcasting activity that in which the government is involved, to essentially encourage members of the public to minimise their social interaction. And that's been a pretty sustained message throughout the whole period since lockdown in March, but it has become intensified in the course of the last few weeks. And obviously the changes that have been made in the levels restrictions in different localities, whether it was the move of certain areas from level 2 into level 3 or the level 3 to level 4 restrictions, have with them brought some practical measures which remove the opportunity for social interaction, because there are fewer facilities open or accessible for social interaction to take place. But then also come with them a message which is about encouraging people to reduce voluntarily their social interaction. And that messaging has been pretty sustained by the government, will continue to be so. And indeed, even around about the 5 days of relaxed restrictions between the 23rd and the 27th of December, the government's message is, here's an opportunity that can be taken, but you're not obliged to take it if members of the public don't wish to do so. And that's part of the message about trying to get across to people the best way to avoid spreading the virus is to minimise social interaction.
Ms Robson.
So I was just going to say, so you're not saying to people, you know, from 10 days out of the Christmas period, you should start isolating. It's not going to be as specific as that. It's more just try to generally reduce your social interaction.
It's not in any way a change of direction from the advice that the government has taken. I would contend that the government, well, if we go back to the fact guidance, avoid crowded places. Keep 2 meters apart. Implicit in the FACTS guidance is that whole question of minimising social interaction. It's completely alien to human beings, but we're having to say it because that is the way that we interrupt the spread of the virus. So that's a consistent part of the government's messaging. And in that respect, I think the evidence is there that members of the public have significantly reduce their social interaction in general, and in response to some of the restrictions that are in place, are doing it quite specifically in a number of areas where the degree of social interaction is reducing considerably.
Okay. Just finally, on something that came up earlier on from Annabel Ewing about support for small businesses, I was pleased to see that Tesco have announced that they are paying back the rates relief money, and Kate Forbes, the finance secretary, made some reference to those resources hopefully being targeted at support to small businesses. From recollection, I hope I've got that right. Is there any more detail at this stage or around that, or is that something that the Scottish Government is working through the detail of?
Well, I think I first of all want to welcome and applaud the decision that Tesco have taken. I think it's a wise and appropriate decision to take, because obviously supermarkets have been able to operate throughout the whole of the period. They've had more economic and business opportunity than many other organisations, and also we have all relied on them and we're grateful to them for what they did. But I think the move by Tesco to repay the business rates relief is a real contribution to the common good and the common purpose of our society, and I welcome it. And it's a not insignificant sum of money as well that they plan to return to the public purse. So I would encourage others to follow in the example of Tesco, because there are a number of other organisations who will have similarly benefited from the opportunity that Tesco have had. And obviously, we are focused on making sure that that support can then be added to the measures that are in place to support other organisations who've not had the economic opportunity that Tesco have had. And I think that begins to address some of the difficult issues that Annabel Ewing raised about the fact that some organisations are perfectly sustainable businesses. The only problem is members of the public can't get across the door of the businesses in sufficient numbers, but they will be able to do so when we get into calmer terrain. And our challenge is to get them there. And nobody wants to see damage and interruption to businesses just because we've got some difficult terrain to get across just now. And initiatives such as the measures taken by Tesco help us to get more businesses there, because there are limits on the public purse.
That's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. And Willie Coffey, please.
Thanks very much, Donald. I wonder if I could just ask for a wee bit of clarification again on the Christmas bubble that we've been talking about. The three household relaxation over the 5 days at Christmas, John, are the families that come together in that arrangement still restricted to be in one household, one location, or can they, the same three families, can they meet, for example, say on Christmas Eve for lunch together in one of the houses, but have Christmas dinner in a restaurant, if a restaurant's open, that is, on Christmas Day? So are they restricted to a single location, or can they have two or three different locations to meet up? The same three households, I mean.
And well, the first point I'd make is that it's the one bubble that's being created. So
yep.
Once people decide who's in their bubble, that's the bubble.
Yes.
Now, I think it would be possible. I'm going to ask Jason Leach to help me on one particular detail, because I think, for example, I think it would be perfectly possible for people to gather in that bubble in one house on Christmas Day, for example, and in a different house on Boxing Day. I think the issue of meeting in a hospitality setting might run up against the hospitality restrictions, but that's the point where I'm going to ask Jason Leach to help me out.
So that's absolutely correct, Mr. Swinney. You remember correctly. So the fundamental answer to your question, Mr. Coffey, is yes. If you choose to have a bubble, remember, brackets, we'd like you to think very carefully. You don't have to have three households. You could just have two, for example. Mm-hmm. You could also not meet for the whole 5 days. You could just meet on Christmas Day. So if you reduce the numbers or the time, you reduce the risk. If, however, you need to, want to meet for longer, you can meet in different locations, but you are obliged to follow the restrictions in the level your place would be in. So that will be pretty restrictive hospitality, wherever you are. And we don't anticipate removing much hospitality restriction in the next few weeks. So therefore, the hospitality bit of your question probably wouldn't happen, but yes, you could meet Christmas Eve and Christmas Day in different houses.
Good. That is really clear. Thank you so much for doing that. My next question is about the hospitality situation that relates to level four. Clearly, we're hoping here in East Ayrshire that we might move from level four to level three over the next week or so. And one of the points that the hospitality sector has said to me on a number of occasions is that the 6 p.m. closure time for level three doesn't really give them any advantage whatsoever in welcoming people to come to their facilities. Is there any scope, do you think, do the numbers that we're seeing at the moment allow us to relax that at all, so that the hospitality sector that's in level three could perhaps remain open to 8 p.m. and therefore get a substantial portion of the likely business that could come to them that at the moment is sadly being lost. So do the numbers give us an idea that might at all be possible when we get to level three, and if we get to level three?
There's 2 points in Mr. Coffey's question, convener, that I would respond to. The first is in relation to the East Ayrshire situation, where good progress has been made, but on the last data that I have available to me, East Ayrshire still remains above the Scottish average for cases per 100,000, although I do compliment the people of Ayrshire on the reductions. The reductions look to me to be down by about 30% over the last 2 weeks. So good progress has been made, and I suspect the numbers I have in front of me don't yet do full justice to the application of the level four restrictions that are in place. So I'd be optimistic that will continue to come down. I think we still have to be very cautious about what will be possible to be undertaken, because we have to get the baseline down to fulfil the points that I made in my answer to Monica Lennon earlier on about the three-month horizon. The second point is in relation to the composition of level three restrictions, and particularly the 6 p.m. closing time. And the hospitality sector have made representations to the government about the importance of perhaps extending that to maybe 8 p.m. to allow an early evening sitting and a middle of the evening setting, I suppose. Those issues have been aired at the Cabinet, and we're looking at those questions. I suspect we'll have further examination of those questions to see whether we can in any way change those arrangements. The point I would make is that where we are having to put on restrictions in some shape or other to reduce the prevalence of the virus. But if we, for example, change the composition of an area, of a level, we would be as it's just the flip side of the coin of taking an area out of a level into a different level to reduce the level. And we know that's a difficult decision, because that potentially fuels the prevalence of the virus. So we have to proceed with great care on these questions, because the more we allow people to interact, the more the virus will spread. It's, I'm afraid, as crude and as blunt as that.
Okay. Now, last query, convener, is on behalf of the sporting and equestrian people. There are many of them in Ayrshire, and a question that they ask me frequently is why they continue to be closed when they really don't have any close contact within the sport whatsoever. They do get numbers of people attending equestrian events, but they're no way are they coming close together. And in fact, when they're competing, it's single persons that are competing at a time. So I wonder if yourself, John or Jason, could explain the thinking behind that kind of sport and why that continues to be restricted at this stage, given their lack of one-to-one contact that they have within the sport.
I think this is an example of what I think is we'll get into very specific areas where it is tricky because of the, it may appear on one hand that these are relatively isolated events, but there is a degree of interaction, people coming together to make them happen, that can fuel the virus. And I suppose what we're trying to do is to minimise the complexity of arrangements in the way in which we take forward some of our constraints. And the more we make those regulations or exemptions bespoke for individual settings, the more difficult it is for us to apply a more general suppression of the virus. And that's the challenge we're trying to reconcile.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. Thanks, convener.
Thank you. Can I just finish with, and I know First Minister's question starts very soon, but we also have Alison Irvine here to answer questions on travel and transport. And next week, the committee is hearing from stakeholders in the travel and transport sectors. I just wondered, Alison, if I could ask you about the Christmas period and what you felt the impact will be on public transport of this 5-day period in terms of, you know, potential overcrowding and capacity, etc. I wonder if you could help us with that.
Thank you, convener. Just check you can hear me. Yeah. Good. Okay. So, from a Transport Scotland perspective, we've set up a team. We call it the Christmas Planning Team. We are looking at what we expect in terms of demand levels. Although I think, as was touched on earlier by Mr. Swinney and Professor Leach, estimating sort of the numbers of people who are likely to want to take part in sort of social activity over this period, and indeed travel to do so, is exceptionally hard to estimate. But we are looking at what information that we have. We're also working with the operators in terms of keeping an eye on their advanced booking levels. At this point in time, we are not anticipating any problems within the transport network within Scotland, although obviously we're keeping that under constant review. We're also working with the Department for Transport, particularly on cross-border services, and that's particularly prevalent as on the rail network. Most of the rail services are which go across border you have to book, so that gives us an element of control in that respect to help manage demand. And from our perspective, we're looking to manage the demand on the transport network in a way that is safe and as safe as possible for those who choose to travel at that time.
Thank you for that. I don't know if either the Deputy First Minister or Professor Leach want to add to that.
I have nothing to add.
No, only that as I said right at the beginning, that we remain concerned about the Christmas period, and travel is one element of that. So we ask people to follow the guidance that's been in place for months now around safely travelling if they choose to travel.
Thank you, everybody. That concludes our business for this meeting. Can I thank the Deputy First Minister and his supporting officials for coming to give evidence to us? It's very helpful. And our next meeting is next Thursday, the 10th of December, and the clerks will provide information. And so can I thereby close the meeting? Thank you.